Sports Northwest is brought to you in part by Rainier Beer. The Oregon Ducks are in a tough situation. Idle last Saturday, the Ducks must now face the number 3 ranked Washington Huskies. After a season-ending injury to Danny O'Neill, head coach Rich Brooks continues to search for a starting quarterback. Though displaying a powerful arm, junior Brett Salisbury injured a shoulder in practice this week and is out for today's game. While the defense has played well at times, the 3-3 Ducks are trying to avoid possessing a losing record for the first time in 4 years. For the Huskies, their mission remains clear. After Cal gave them all they could handle, their goal is the Rose Bowl. Unheralded Jay Berry grabbed the spotlight after rushing for 143 yards and a touchdown against the Golden Bears. The Killer Bees, Berry and Bryant, will have open season on the Ducks today. The challenge for the Huskies is to stay unbeaten and run for the roses. The Ducks want to fly high today, and the Huskies want clear skies to Pasadena. It's all next on Prime Sports Northwest. It is windy. It's October. That means the Oregon Ducks must be in town. It's time for that good old Northwest rivalry. The University of Oregon Ducks coming in to take on the third-ranked undefeated Washington Huskies. Hello again, everybody. I'm Don Poyer, along with Chuck Nelson and the voice of the Oregon Ducks, Todd McKim, here on Prime Sports Northwest. It's great to have him up here. We've been friends for many, many years, and we always look forward to these broadcasts when both teams, of course, are on Prime Sports Northwest. And we get to have a reunion of sorts when we have these broadcasts. Now, normally, this is one of the greatest rivalries in the country. And usually you can say, throw out the records, it doesn't matter. But when you bring in the ingredients of injuries, guys, I think that's really decimated Oregon, hasn't it, Todd?
Oregon has been decimated both psychologically and physically. When you look at the injuries, you're talking about starters. First of all, offensively, the Ducks are down to their third-string quarterback, losing O'Neill and Salisbury. David Collinsworth is their best offensive lineman. Defensively, they've lost the front three of Cummins, Labonte, and Woods. Some thought that was maybe the best defensive line in the Pac-10 coming in and one of the best in the country.
Now, as far as the quarterbacks, we thought Salisbury would play today. He gets injured. Now we're going to see another Musgrave, Doug. That's
right. Doug Musgrave is the brother of Bill Musgrave, and if he has the same kind of success against the Huskies as did his brother, maybe Oregon has a chance this afternoon. But he has never started a college game, a transfer from Michigan. He's got his hands full this afternoon.
Speaking of hands full, inside linebacker, this man amazes me. Joe Farwell, badly injured all week with an ankle or all season, and he's not very heavy, and he still plays well.
He hasn't practiced much. It has affected his play, yet he is still the leading tackler. And here's a guy that plays inside linebacker at about, and we are being generous, 200 pounds.
And he's going against people, 290, running backs, 230, 240. It's amazing. He's an outstanding athlete. The Pac-10 standings, I think it's time to look at that. We're about midway through the season. It's no secret Washington's on top, of course. 3-0 as far as conference play, 6-0 overall. Then the rest of them, California, good shape. UCLA coming on, Arizona State, USC, and Chuck. And then, of course, Oregon now at 1-2 as they struggle with the injuries.
Well, Washington, obviously, the big game last week against California, 2 unbeatens, 2 top 7 ranked teams. Washington with a big win there. But they've got 5 conference games left to go. Obviously, a rival game here with Oregon. Like you said, anything can happen. Usually Oregon in a tough situation here today. But when you talk about Washington the last couple of years, you want to talk about the running game.
And that's Jay Berry, who came up with 143 big ones last week.
Pac-10 Player of the Week for that effort. Between Jay Berry, who was listed as a co-starter along with Bean O'Brien, you're talking about more production than last year when the Husky running game and Greg Lewis got all the attention, but they're averaging 163 yards a game from the tailback position.
Jaime Fields defensively has played so well, it's kept Brett Collins out of the lineup, and Brett's a great linebacker.
When you've got two guys at weak linebacker like Jaime Fields and Brett Collins, you got to feel good about that. Collins started the majority of the games last year when Jaime Fields was injured. Jaime Fields came back. Brett Collins gets injured this year, and Jaime Fields comes in and is making all sorts of plays. He's got all sorts of tackles for loss. He's got interceptions. He's got quarterback sacks. Yeah. He's causing fumbles, recovering fumbles. He's a very active player at the weak side linebacker position.
Now, as far as the game keys themselves, let's see what you've got to see. We'll see if Todd agrees.
Well, obviously, when Oregon comes in here and when Washington has the ball, Washington is going to have to keep Oregon off the field and not give them any hope. You've got a situation where you've got a major underdog coming in here, and you don't want them to feel like they have any chances. Oregon on defense has got to make big plays. Turnovers, turnovers, turnovers. Washington is a team that can strike fast. Oregon has got to make some plays on defense. They've got three interceptions returned for touchdowns this year. That defense of Oregon is going to have to do that also. Now, when you go to the other side of the ball, when Oregon has the ball, that aggressive Husky defense, they'll send a lot of people and put a lot of pressure on their corners playing man-to-man. Musgrave and that Oregon offense are going to have to make some big plays out of that.
And I think one of the keys as far as the Ducks are concerned, they know that they will make some bad plays offensively. Washington has done it to everybody in the country they've played so far in the last couple of years. They must maintain their poise. The crowd will be loud. They will make some bad plays, but they can't let that get to them.
Well, and that's what that defense will try to do. The game key for that Washington defense is rattle the new guy. You're going to either have, even if Musgrave is out of the game, you've got Croston in there, and he's a new guy too. So they're going to put, like they always do, put a lot of pressure on two new quarterbacks.
And let us not forget, it is still a rivalry. There's still a lot of Oregon fans here, as usual. It's going to be a wonderful game, and third year in a row that Oregon has had to come up here. They'll go to Eugene next year. We've got the kickoff between Oregon and Washington coming up next. Here it's Rainier. Along with Chuck Nelson, Todd McKim. And the weather today, as we said, gray, cold, windy as the Ducks take on the undefeated Washington Huskies. Temperature, it's down there too. It's not all that comfortable this afternoon. As you can see, temperature at 50 degrees, it'll get lower, and the forecast calls for some wet stuff. We shall see whether or not that happens. As far as the series, it's been a long one. In fact, Washington has played Oregon more than any other opponent, and they have the nod in the overall series, 51-28-5 ties. And it's been pretty much all Washington in regards to games here in Seattle. Last time, by the way, that Oregon won was 1980 up here. You may all recall that game. In fact, they thumped the Huskies a pretty good one that day.
Some of us recall that game probably more than others.
Teams back out onto the field already. As far as Oregon itself, Rich Brooks now passes Len Casanova with his game today. I think Todd McKim has called probably all of them.
Please. Not all of them.
Brooks, his career mark, as you see. And a good note to that is his last 8 years for Brooks is 47-39. So he has continued to build this program. As far as Washington, James is 13-3 against the Ducks, 11-3 against Rich Brooks and company. So, kind of play football. Oregon won the toss. They deferred. Washington chose to receive. And so Tommy Thompson, who handles the kickoff chores, will boot it now for the Ducks, and we're underway. High short kick. Tommy Smith at the 18. Looks for the seam, trying to get outside, and is finally brought down at the 36-yard line. Not a bad return by Tommy Smith, who starts at Rover for the Huskies, did so the last couple of games. For Washington at quarterback, as usual, it will be Billy Joe Hobert, the sophomore out of Puyallup, who had a tough game last week against a very good California team, but got the victory. And Mario Bailey with one reception last week, but it was for a touchdown as the Huskies went on to win it. Those are your backs and receivers. So first and 10 now as we go from the 36-yard line. Right off the bat, Jay Berry, good first down play, close to a first down, up near the 47-yard line as the Huskies go on the ground. Jay Berry with 143 yards last week. As you see, the defensive line, Romeo Bandison leading that group of young people, the normal starters, all gone due to injury. James Batista leads the group with Connor. Joe Farwell, very light but very tenacious linebacker. Coda Oliver, Smith, and Eric Castle. Castle the leader for that secondary. And a very fine one, we might point out, for the Oregon Ducks. They'll measure on the approximate 10-yard run by Jay Berry. And it is the first down on the first carry for Washington. And that followed a 19-yard kickoff return by Tommy Smith.
with the weather being as it is cold, it is windy, the running game will be very important. Washington probably would be content just to run the ball on every down if they can.
Washington 11th in the nation, first in the Pac-10 in rushing. First and 10 from the 47-yard line. Again, Barry, not so much this time. As number 54, Gary Williams gets in on the stop, a gain of 3 yards.
See, almost 500 yards in 6 games for Jay Barry, 77 yards a game. We said in our opening that tailback position generates a lot of yards, almost 1,200 yards between the top 3 tailbacks, Bryant, Barry, and Napoleon Kaufman.
Ball right at midfield on 2nd down and 7. Wide receivers to both sides. Bailey to the right and McKay to the short side. Again to Barry. He's in trouble. Andy Connors almost gets him, and then finally Joe Farwell, along with a couple of other Ducks, make the kill, and no gain, maybe 6 inches at best.
Andy Connors is a very good outside linebacker. In fact, he has got great size, 6'4", 240 pounds, was a decathlete in high school, and it might be tough to run on his side. They may like to try a little bit on Terrell Edwards, who weighs about 18 pounds less.
3rd down and long for the Dogs, 3rd and 7. No gain, ball right at midfield. 2 wide receivers to the left side, and McKay at the top of your screen. Billy Joe got room to run. He'll do it. Flag goes down. He has the distance for the first down, but let's see what the flag's all about. Right on the line of scrimmage on the far side of the field. Boy, I'll tell you, this is like a broken record from last week. A lot of penalties on the Dogs last week against California after the 11-yard gain. Motion. On Washington.
Not only have the Huskies this year shown a penchant for penalties at times, but those times have always been critical. It seems every time there's a motion penalty, it's a first down called back. It's a touchdown called back, or at least a big gain called back.
As far as the leaders, you know all these names, certainly. The Killer Bees, Bryant and Barry, the running, and Bailey, who has had a sensational season. 31 catches. Same formation. 2 left, 1 to the right. On 3rd and 12. Going across. Bailey. Very close. Oh, I don't know. We'll see if they give him the first down. Eric Castle makes the tackle. Made the hit right about where he needed to be. Let's see. Well, they'll call the first down with the forward progress. Needed 13 and got it.
Outstanding protection for Billy Joe Hobert. Wide open, Mario Bailey. Almost makes a cardinal mistake here. When you've got 3rd and 12, make sure you get your first down. We'll try to get a big play later. Luckily enough, had the catch, had the first down.
1st and 10 on the Duck 41-yard line. Little play action. They send a linebacker. Better hurry. McKay with a reception. Sliding catch down at the 34-yard line of Oregon. Who'd they send that time? Was that Cota?
That was a blitz by the strong safety, Chad Cota, and he hurdled one tackler, but he could not get to Hobert before he released the football. You'll see on the right portion of the screen, right there, Cota number 7, and then he almost got up in time to get Hobert.
Nice block by Matt Jones, the fullback, to slow him down.
And a good job by Orlando McKay to continue coming back to his quarterback.
Got an audible now by Hobert. They gain 7. Oh, it's 2nd down and 3. Going with the toss sweep. Matt Jones leads the way. Jay Barry carries. Has the first down inside the 30-yard line. Farwell, Romeo Banderson, a couple of other Ducks on the play. Gain of 5 yards and the first down.
You look at the outstanding personnel for Oregon. You look at the inside linebackers, Farwell and Batista, leading in tackles. Ernest Jones didn't even make the trip. He's the leading sack man, and the top interceptor is Smith.
On 1st and 10, more play action and the rollout. A lot of time back against the groove. Oh, Orlando McKay right in the breadbasket and can't hold on. Pass was low, but catchable.
Problem last week for Washington in the Cal game. Billy Joe Hobert missing some wide open receivers. 4 big plays. That time the flow goes to the left. Billy Joe Hobert sets and throws back to Orlando McKay. You see everybody going from left to right on your screen. Hobert's going to throw it back here. Ball thrown out in front of Orlando McKay, and you're looking at the at least a first down inside the 5-yard line.
So it's 2nd down and 10 as Barry goes in motion. So they have 3 receivers to the left and 1 to the right. Here comes the blitz. Good defensive call. Trying to go to Mario Bailey on the blitz. Great call by defensive coordinator Denny Schuler.
Well, it was maybe a great call, but his personnel didn't line up right. They put the man Barry in motion, and the Huskies had two receivers on the near side and only one Oregon defender. And instead, Hobart tried to go to the inside man, the hot receiver on the blitz, which he's probably told to do. That's what he's coached to do. But if he had looked at the man in motion, he'd have been able to throw for a touchdown. Open.
You've got to assume that the defense is going to adjust to that. You can't adjust to that big a mistake.
Third down and 10. Got to hurry. Down he goes. 49, Terrell Edwards, the right outside linebacker playing on the left, comes around for the kill, and it'll be fourth down.
Edwards making his first start as an Oregon Duck, replacing Ernest Jones, who was the leading Oregon sack man. He just beats him with speed. Right to the outside, in on Hobart. He never had a chance.
Lincoln Kennedy doesn't know what happened. Got around him in a hurry.
Not easy to do, 330 pounds of tackle there. You got to move those feet, Mr. Kennedy. Not only is that a sack, but it's a big sack, taking the Huskies out of field goal range. Quarterbacks are taught there, at least throw it away.
And the wind was to their back. The punt by Waddell gets a good roll for the Huskies and is brought down to rest near the 12-yard line. Darius Turner comes up with the ball. So Oregon's defense doing a great job, and Washington getting a little bit of their own medicine with the stunning gambling defense by the Ducks.
Well, I think Oregon defensively believes their front three cannot put enough pressure on Hobart to make him throw the ball away or throw bad passes. They have to apply pressure, and you'll see on third and long situations, they'll come with five, six, seven people.
They've got nothing to lose.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's interesting how the crowd gets more excited about the defense than the offense.
And they like to disrupt the offense with the noise here in Husky Stadium, of course. Receivers one to each side. And they go to Sean Burwell on the first carry. Sean, an outstanding running back. He, too, been fighting the injury bug with the bad ankle. As we see the starting lineups, Burwell, who carried the last time, Juan Shedrick at fullback, the split end, Harris, Anthony Jones, and Jeff Thomason, very good tight end. And the big folks up front, might remember Steve Harden, folks up here in the Northwest, out of Snohomish, Richard freshman playing at the tackle. You knew I'd get a Snohomish plug in there, guys. Second down and 9. Anthony Jones to the right side. Long count by Doug Musgrave in his first start. Going back to throw. His receiver stepped out of bounds as Ronnie Harris was going down against Walter Bailey for Washington. So already they're having Musgrave go back and see what he can find going upstairs. Defensively, Andy Mason with a good game against California. Also Tyrone Rogers, Steve Emptman, you know about him. Donald Jones, Jaime Fields, a sensational effort against the Bears, Hoffman and Fraley in the linebacker core. And then your secondary, as you see. It is third down and 9 with three wide receivers to the right side. Musgrave going to throw again. Across the middle, Burwell. But good coverage on the part of number 54, Dave Hoffman, the inside linebacker for the Huskies. It'll be fourth down.
Well, Oregon not trying to do anything too fancy. They do not want to turn the ball over at this spot on the field. A safe pass, and as a result, even if they have to punt, they just don't want to give the Huskies good field position. They'd like to make the Huskies drive as long as they can before scoring.
Rich Brooks' punter is Tommy Thompson, who's averaging a little over 38 yards per, and Bean O'Brien is back to receive. Bino getting higher in the Pac-10 rankings as the season goes along. Good punt. Nose just coming over on the spiral back to the 36-yard line. Bryant has to sit down on it after fumbling. No chance for a return. Huskies look less than inspired at this stage anyway. 45-yard boot. That might have been, well, looks like he had the wind possibly with him. But no return, which is even more important.
Well, Tommy Thompson may be as valuable a weapon for Oregon today as anybody else. He was a second-team All-Pac-10 selection a year ago as a true freshman. And I would imagine he'll punt the ball a lot today. And if he can do a good job, that'll certainly help out the defense.
His net average, averaging almost 39 yards gross, but his net average is almost 37. So he can hang it up and they can cover it.
With Bailey wide to the right side and McKay to the left, it is first down and 10 from the 36 of Washington. 9:26 remaining in the first quarter. No score. Jay Berry trying to challenge the inside, and I think Romeo Bandison was one of the first there, number 97. Only 2 yards. Yeah, this is something. More yardage this year.
Split it up amongst two guys. See, over 1,000 yards for the team of Bryant and Barry. And then you throw Napoleon Kaufman and his 152 yards in there as the number three guy. And you've got almost 1,200 yards from the tailback position in only six games.
They're well ahead of the pace on the ground from last year. Second down and eight now from the 38. Billy Joe going to the air. McKay. Little inside slant going against Darryl Smith, number 20. Should be good for the first down, and it is. 10-yard gain.
Orlando McKay has improved dramatically on this time of route from last year. You can see finding the seam, the ball thrown just inside the leaping Chad Cota and just in front of the defensive corner. Orlando McKay, a much better inside route receiver this year.
First and 10, Barry. One man to beat, and that was Darryl Smith. And, of course, Eric Castle coming over to fill. Nice run of 12 yards by Barry. Jay is picking it up from where he left off down in Berkeley.
Much improved as the season has progressed. Starter the first few games.
You know, he raised a good point about that, Chuck. Everybody's saying after the game last week, you've really improved. He says, I haven't improved. I'm just playing more.
Yeah, and he said, you guys are the only ones who think I've improved. I think I've been good all along.
First down and 10 from the Duck 40-yard line. And again, DeBerry trying to find something, but nothing there. Gary Williams, number 54, and Andy Connor. The outside linebacker, they'll give him 1 yard.
I would expect the Huskies to really test Oregon in the middle. They've got a nose tackle that's 5 foot 11, 250 pounds, an inside linebacker that's 200 pounds. And if nothing else, you're going to keep those people at home and they can't fly around the ball. And so I would expect the Huskies to really try to pound that middle.
Point well taken. Wide receivers, one to each side. There again, they challenge it, and look who rose to the occasion. Hey, I'm impressed with Bandison, the right end. He's done well getting in there. Well, Barry on the play that time, but Bandison stirred things up.
Bandison played soccer in the Netherlands, where he was born, and then came to the United States as a foreign exchange student, played football, and at 6'5", 270 pounds, it's hard to imagine him on a soccer field as a midfielder, but he would be rather imposing, to say the least, and he's playing very well to start the game.
He could clog up a goal mouth, I tell you that.
He'd fill up the whole circle at midfield. So it's third and nine for Washington. At the Oregon 39, three receivers, Hobart looking right, got a man close to a first down. Let's see where they mark it. Curtis Gaspar, the man with the reception, Muhammad Oliver defending. Looks like they'll give it to him, a gain of nine, and it is a first down for Washington.
Washington doing a good job on third down conversions here. You see help from everybody, lots of time. Well thrown ball to the outside of Curtis Gaspar. You see Muhammad Oliver inside. Billy Joe Hobart reading that play and throwing the ball outside where Gaspar is the only man to make a play.
McKay and Bailey both to the left side this time. First and 10, just inside the 30 of Oregon. Little option. And the pitch to Barry. And nice coverage again by Joe Farwell, number 51. Picked up a couple yards, maybe three. Farwell, yeah, he didn't look. Yeah, I'll say 195, maybe 200.
If he had a good pregame meal. But he has a nose for the football.
Very active.
Very active. In fact, Coach Brooks says, I think sometimes Joe is in the other team's huddle. He just seems to know where the ball is going.
I'll tell you, brains is 75% of it. Second down at seven. Same formation. This time they go with Darius Turner getting the call at fullback. Short game. Farwell again in the bottom of the pile, number 51.
Darius Turner improving this week from the number three fullback to the number two fullback. Was the starter all year last year in that Rose Bowl championship season. His back is healed up now well enough where they've moved him up to number two. He's been very effective with those cutback runs.
Third down again for Washington. They've seen a lot of those today. Third and four with Bailey and McKay again to the left side. High formation in the backfield. Bailey. Oregon with a nice scheme as they sent number 45, James Batista, or he read it well.
Washington working the heck out of that short side of the field.
Well, this will be interesting. Are they going to kick with all the problems they've had with field goals, or will they go for it? It is fourth down and two, and Chuck says no question they're going for it.
Mark Bruner, the second tight end, being sent into the game by Coach Don James. Not so much a condemnation of Travis Hansen in the kicking game, more a chance to establish that we are the dominant team in this game. Fourth and one, you can't stop us.
Double tight end, 2 yards to go. Bailey wide to the left side. Again, the toss sweep. Bailey! Or you'd rather Barry, I don't know. We'll see. Let's see where they mark it. Had to get just inside the 20-yard line, and that's about where he laid down.
Second effort by Barry to get it even close to bring the chains out. Was stopped originally at the point of attack. You can see, again, aggressive play by Oregon. They get upfield a little bit, try to stuff the play. Right here, the spin Castle. Move and the fall forward. Eric Castle trying to put the wrap on as you see the measurement.
Boy, if they make it, it's not by much. That had to be by less than from the stripe out to the point of the ball.
Yeah, it's a first down, but I don't think Don James proved the point that he wanted to make.
No.
Oregon has to draw some sort of moral victory from the play.
I like what I see Oregon doing defensively today. They're attacking.
Well, again, they've got nothing to lose.
Right.
Size-wise, athlete-wise, this is a better team, but we're gonna mess them up before they can get started.
And their problems haven't been defensively this year.
Right. On first and 10, Dean O'Brien with the call. Short yardage, that was the same formation as last play, with Bailey alone going man-to-man with Darrell Smith.
The other thing this is doing, though, is it is wearing on that Oregon defense. They only have the three linemen up front, and nobody else has any experience at all as backups. So how long can Oregon hold up with this continual pounding of the running game, even though it might not culminate in a touchdown?
Little tighter formation. Bailey, the only wide receiver, on second down and 8. Hobart still with it. Wants to go in the corner. Bailey! Touchdown, Washington! 10 touchdown receptions this year. ...17-yard play. Well, we just mentioned this matchup, and they went to it.
The post-corner route. You can see Darrell Smith gets turned around. Not exactly beat that badly, but Mario Bailey just makes a better adjustment on the ball here.
In fact, it looked like Smith went for the interception as opposed to just trying to knock it down.
Travis Hansen, 19 of 21 this year. Gets it, makes it 20 of 22 as Mario Bailey. By the way, that reception is Bailey's 103rd career reception, tying him for fourth with Mo Hill, one of his heroes, as a matter of fact, on the Husky all-time receiving list. Back in a moment. Feeling about this type of rivalry game, Washington and Oregon. Here are what the coaches think about this game.
Oregon's always played very well in our game. Both teams look at it as a rival game, and we have Oregon players on our team, and they have Washington players on theirs, and we're close and in the same league, so it'll be a lot of fun out there.
Well, Washington is the best-looking team I've seen in this conference ever. Going back to when I played in leather helmets at Oregon State, coached a long time, and they're as good-looking football teams I've ever seen play in this conference. It's not a good scenario for us as taking a battered and bruised team with a lot of injuries into Seattle, struggling as we are, particularly on the offensive side of the ball, facing the best defense in the country.
And his team will face that defense again now that Washington has just scored on its second series. It's 7-0. Jason Crabb with the short kickoff. Muhammad Oliver at the 6. Good there. Looked like Hillary Butler got a piece of him, number 45, and that slowed him up. And was brought down after an 18-yard return. So Doug Musgrave, youngster that he is, good bloodline, we know that. If he could play half as good as his brother did, half as well.
Just tear that nameplate off of the back of the old jersey and put it on the new one.
Change the number.
For those interested in knowing where Bill is at, he was originally drafted by the Cowboys, then was released and has been signed as a practice player by the San Francisco 49ers.
And that'll work out better for him in the long run anyway. Well,
you can learn a lot from that San Francisco offensive staff.
Not bad working under Joe Montana when he's healthy, too. First and 10 now for the Oregon Ducks with two receivers to the left side. Musgrave wanting to throw on first down. A nice safe pass outside. Anthony Jones, number 18. And a good first down gain. Gain of 10 yards.
A year ago, Anthony Jones broke into his own right here in Seattle against the Huskies. He had 6 receptions as he was filling in for the injured Michael McClellan. Here, the just a short out pattern, a little crossing pattern between the two receivers. He's open. Ed Ortigan gets his first down of the ballgame.
Anthony Jones, a junior from Cerritos, California. 20 receptions this year, and he's averaging over 12 per. First and 10 on the 34-yard line. Two receivers right side on the ground. Burwell, penetration, and purple jerseys all over the place. Looks like it might have been Emptman, the first in there to grab from behind.
Emptman indeed the first to get to Burwell. But Andy Mason made the play. You've got two people pulling for Oregon. Andy Mason takes them both on. Watch the number 13 if we can see it. Watch the pile stack up. There's Andy Mason.
That's what did it.
Steve Emptman, all he has to do is pick up the leftovers.
Mason stood up Heath Howington. So it's second down and 11. Yet another TFL, tackle for loss for Washington. They need 11 yards. Three receivers to the right. Musgrave has time. Anthony Jones. And a good gain as he runs right into Shane Falcoa.
And that was a great read by Musgrave because initially the man was not open. He pump faked, let the receiver clear the backer, and then found the crease in the zone. Watch the little pump here as he clears actually the safety and the linebacker, Hoffman right there. Good reception, held onto the ball. So now it's third and short.
Walter Bailey delivering that blow rather than Falcoa. He was around behind.
Walter Bailey, a big game for him being from Portland.
Third down and a short one. Jones to the right. That's it for receivers. And there's movement on the tackle. Left side might have been Matt Martin.
This is a scenario that really plagued Oregon in the first three games of the year. And Chuck, you alluded to the fact the Huskies have had problems. It's not sometimes the distance of the penalty, but it's the timing of the penalty. Instead of third and short, you feel you've got a decent chance.
Right.
It's now third and long, third and six, and against Washington's defense, it's much more difficult to get 6 yards than one.
You see Rich Brooks pulls everybody off of the field here. Get a look at the left side of your screen. Matt Martin, number 71, getting a little anxious there. So instead of third and one, you've got third and six. All the tight ends and fullbacks come off the field. All the little guys go back on.
Trips to the right. Third down and six, as Todd said. Whole different page in the playbook now. Burwell. Chico Fraley takes a shot and misses, but there are two more right there waiting for him. It's Dave Hoffman and Dana Hall and Shane Falcoa.
The option, a tough play to run against Washington. They are so fast that by the time the play gets out to the corner, it looks like there's room, but those inside people can close so quickly.
Yeah.
You see Chico Fraley spins him around and then take your pick.
That's about the best example I think I've seen of team speed for Washington, because that's a well-conceived play.
It's not a bad idea because you have man coverage on all the receivers, and
right.
You hope nobody can get there in time, but great speed.
Thompson back to punt again as Bean O'Brien waits back on his own 24. Flag down, ball is blocked. Dana Hall's the man who got a piece of it. Out of bounds it goes. Let's wait and see what the call is. Did Smith do it? I thought it might have been Dana Hall.
Tommy Smith got a hand on it, but one of the reasons he might have been there was he may have lined up offside.
A little early.
The Huskies coming after Tommy Thompson very aggressively there.
Well, Cal blocked a punt last week for a touchdown against Oregon, and the Huskies have been notorious in games against Oregon in particular, blocking punts, returning punts, so it's a critical phase of the game and could be one of the early big plays.
The call does go against Washington, takes care of, turns that third and one into third and six, back into third and one.
Fourth and one.
The fourth and one, excuse me.
Apparently it's against Oregon.
Ooh.
No, they were. Never mind.
Interesting. All that for naught.
Tommy Smith on the right side of your screen comes inside Chad Cota. First rule of punt blocking is make him go outside, make him take the long route. Chad Cota broke that rule. Falcoa there to.
It was indeed Tommy Smith who got the hand on it. So it's first and 10 for Washington at the Oregon 45-yard line. McKay comes out to the left side with Bailey to the right. Jones. And Andy Connor is there, number 47. The outside linebacker came in with 21 tackles, 11 of those by himself, and 5 tackles for losses. Connor, big, strong kid.
Talk about Oregon's defense, and the fact that they're not playing too badly, but they've been put in a position by their offense to defend such a short field.
Last week against Cal, the Bears had the ball first and 10 inside the 50 to start drives 9 times and scored twice.
On 2nd and 7, Dean O'Brien, a little shuffle there, waiting to see what would open up. Wasn't much there as Farwell collapsed to make the play, along with Herman O'Berry.
This is the running game that a lot of people envisioned before the season started. Jay Berry kind of being your workhorse guy, and bring Dean O'Brien in and try to little change of pace, like bringing in the knuckleballer and the fastball pitcher. Dean O'Brien, a guy that can score from any distance.
Bailey and McKay to the left on 3rd down and 3. Dino, look out. Oh, he got the first down. Some improvising as he was thinking cutback. But a couple of Oregon Ducks stayed home. So he had to fight for whatever he could get, and it looks like it was enough.
Well, this is what's scary about Washington. They'll pound at you and pound at you, get 3-4, 3-4, 5, and then all of a sudden get 60. And that's what can happen on those cutback plays.
That's California.
Exactly right. Well, they've done it all year. They've had big plays.
Through the air and on the ground. That's what's so scary. Dean O'Brien with 6 touchdowns of over 50 yards in his career.
Well, we talk about balance, too. Right now the Huskies, 104 total yards, 45 rushing, 59 passing. So the beat goes on. 1st and 10 now on the 34 of Oregon. Bryant getting the call one more time. Chad Cota, the first to get in there, number 7. After a 4-yard gain.
As that defense wears down, it's hard enough to play against an offense that's been on the field a long time. But when you start throwing fresh players in that are as ball carriers, it makes it even more difficult for that defense to keep up.
And what this does is also set up play action pass.
Should be the last play of the quarter. 7 seconds remain. See if they get it off in time. 3 seconds. Bryant and net right there. Again, good penetration by Bandison, number 97, slowing it up. They might give him 1 yard. Who got in there? Was it Williams? The first.
A lot of activity in the middle. That's maligned Oregon defense. Defensive line. Malapai with the stop there.
That's it for the first quarter. Washington comes up with 7 points. The Ducks holding on, playing some good football so far. We'll be back for the second quarter right after this.
Wink. You're watching the Washington Huskies on Prime Sports Northwest, home of the Pac-10.
Welcome back. I'm Don Poyer with Chuck Nelson. Todd McKim joining us in the booth this afternoon. Kind of giving him the day off. He gets to have some fun today. Instead of having to call the whole Oregon game, he gets to sit up here, relax, drink coffee, work on his suntan.
Yeah.
47 degrees, and we're freezing our
freezing our microphones off.
That's right. Freezing. Just looking at scoring by quarter, this has been a tough one for Oregon. Only 12 points in the second quarter all year to Washington's 92, and they've given up only 20. It's amazing. Washington still hasn't given up any points in the fourth quarter. 3rd down and 5 from the 29. Wanting to go deep. Bailey, touchdown, Washington.
What a pretty, pretty play.
That was a perfect pass. 29-yard touchdown pass to Bailey, his 2nd of the day.
Well, they've beaten Smith to the outside, and now they've beaten him to the inside. And so Darryl Smith, the all-time or the leading interceptor for Oregon, doesn't know which way they're going to go. You notice what Hobart did? He looked off the safety, Eric Castle,
yeah.
And Castle could never get deep enough to get back in time.
Extra point is blocked.
Why don't they pick it up and try to run with it?
I was going to say, they could pick it up and go.
Oregon has nothing to lose there.
Rolling the wrong direction.
The 5th extra point that the Huskies have missed this year.
Well, a couple of years ago, the Ducks blocked extra point and a field goal against the Huskies, so both teams have had blocked kicks so far today.
We'll be back with the second quarter here in just a moment.
Hey,
Pac-10 volleyball action on Prime Sports Northwest when ASU, Arizona State, takes on the Oregon Ducks this Monday, 4 o'clock on Prime Sports Northwest. We've got the Ducks at hand right now. They trail 13-0 after the extra point attempt was blocked by the Ducks. And they trail 13-0. 14-54 remaining in the second quarter.
Well, that's not going to do a lot for the confidence or lack thereof that Don James has in his kicking game, field goal, PAT units.
Todd, it's been driving him nuts all year. It's really been tough. And when you go 1-for-3 in field goal attempts against California, you're darn lucky to come out of there.
The scoring drive set up by a blocked punt. The Huskies only had to go 45 yards to score.
Blocked kick at both ends of that drive. 2 minutes and 4 seconds. 29 touchdown drives for the Huskies this year. 21 of them have been less than 2 minutes, so that's a long one for them.
Oliver inside his 10, still rolling. And it met by that purple rain as he's brought down after a 15-yard gain.
Remember when you were a kid and you used to go out in the backyard and play kill the guy with the ball? Get about 80 of your buddies jumping onto one pile. There it was on Muhammad Oliver.
You know, I like Musgrave, though. He's not making any silly mistakes.
He looks very poised for a guy with very, very little major college experience. You hate to say it, but he looks a lot like his brother.
I was going to say the same thing. You could tell he's got the thinking ability that his brother had.
Not a real strong-arm guy, but waits and waits and throws the ball where it's supposed to be.
First and 10 from the 20. A wide receiver to each side. They go to the backfield, and Burwell, who gets about three, maybe two or three, out beyond the 22-yard line.
Well, if Sean actually believed he could have gotten through that line untouched, he actually had a good chance for a big gain. Tommy Smith made a very good tackle there, but Burwell entered the hole with both hands on the ball and his head down like, well, who's going to hit me first? That's the psychological advantage that Washington has with their great defense.
Got Tommy Smith down, too, after making that play.
Tommy Smith closed on that one so fast, laid such a blow that he hurt his own shoulder.
Yeah, maybe a shoulder.
And if Burwell had exploded into the hole, let's look at it here. Now watch Burwell. He comes in with his head down and trying to hold onto the ball. And basically Smith just happened to be in the way and really didn't get a good hit on Burwell. But he filled the hole but hurt the shoulder.
Right place at the right time. One of the great things about this Husky defense is the depth that they have. So Tommy Smith goes out and you bring in Paxton Tulele, who started the first four games.
It looks like a stinger, too, the way he's whipping his arm around. Second down, Burwell, big opening as he gets outside up to the 30-yard line and brought down by Shane Palcoa. Much what California succeeded at doing was the quick opener, the quick slant like that. Of course, that's how Chapman got the big TD last week.
You see both Bowie and Harden pull to clear the hole. We'll forget about that offside. Let's get as many bodies as we can, as many blockers as we can over on the play side. And Burwell just follows those big backsides, 260 and 316 through the hole.
Third down and one after the 7-yard gain by Burwell. Anthony Jones wide to the right side. Only need one. And it's the fullback who got it, Juan Shedrick. He is hit by number 53, James Clifford. Shedrick not carrying the ball all that much. Getting a talk or two from Clifford. Maybe they know each other.
Well, they will by the end of the day.
Quite well.
28 carries coming into the game. Have they used him primarily as a lead block, Todd?
Well, they like, Burwell is such a threat that they like to get him the ball as much as possible. Burwell and Shedrick are roommates, so I guess Shedrick's, at least for now, going to settle for the role as the block.
Harris to the left and Jones to the right. On first and 10 from the 33, there goes Burwell in motion. Little finesse pass, but out of bounds, as Ronnie Harris was defended by both Bailey and Palcoa. I like the scheme. I think Oregon is calling the right plays.
Well, it's the execution.
Yep.
That's been the problem for Oregon the last several games. They just haven't been able to execute. And what the Oregon quarterbacks, unfortunately, have done is they've made bad plays, horrible plays in recent games, throwing the interceptions at the wrong time. That way, Musgrave, he throws the ball where only Harris is going to make the catch.
That's right.
There's going to be no interception.
Rich Brooks said this week that one of the reasons that he got the start was he just wanted a guy that wasn't going to kill him. Going to kill me. I don't want big mistakes, man.
And we've got one down on the field right now. Flags down and motion everywhere.
And it'll go against Oregon.
Repeat, second down.
So call it second down and 15 with 13:25 remaining in the second quarter. For what it's worth, it was 14-10 at the end of the first half last year. Washington on top, and then things fell apart. Oh, the wheels came off for Oregon there.
Their first two possessions last year in the third quarter started in Washington territory, and they couldn't move the football.
Second down and 15. They put Burwell out to the right side with two other wide receivers. And now Musgrave is in big time trouble as Steve Emptman, number 90, is in there first. That's five sacks unofficially for Emptman this year. Look at that. The whole defensive unit back there with him. A loss of 4 yards, so it'll be third down and 19.
A familiar sight, Steve Emptman in the opposition backfield. Looks like a quarterback draw here. Either that or Donald Jones just beat Musgrave back to his drop spot. Said, I'm no sense wasting time going backwards. I'm going to tuck it and get what I can get or lose as little as I can get in this case.
So they call it third down and 18. Three wide receivers to the right side. And they play it safe with Burwell right up the middle and nothing doing. Tyrone Rogers stayed home well on that.
That's a situation they just don't want to make a bad play. Let's punt the ball and let our defense get back on the field. Our defense has scored three times this year. Maybe they can make it four and we can get back in it.
Get them how you can get them. It doesn't matter, does it?
So Tommy Thompson back to punt again. This time, the wind is swirling. It's hard to call it. Maybe probably going into the wind as much as anything with Bean O'Brien with the wind to his back. Thompson back on his own 10. Comes the feed. They block it again. Lewis Jones lands on top of it. Flag comes down late. Chico Fraley with the block punt.
Tommy Thompson not getting a whole lot of help from those Oregon Ducks up front. You don't think the Huskies are going to keep coming?
Why not?
Now?
They've already blocked one today. They saw one blocked against, or not two today. They had one blocked last week. They're going to come after him all the time.
We got a penalty against Washington. Assessed after the play. May have been a personal foul. Let's wait and get the official call.
We got arms pointing everywhere here.
Yeah, I don't know what that one is when you got one down the line of scrimmage and one at a team.
Dead
here
ball,
we go.
Personal foul against Washington. First down and 25.
Okay, so it was some sort of extracurricular activity after the play.
After the play. You see Thompson snap a little high, but doesn't take too long. Chico Fraley takes it right in the bed basket. Boy, these guys get excited then. Lewis Jones falls on the play. Everybody's starting to throw blocks, but the ball is on the ground. You saw the flash across your screen coming from left to right. That's where the flag is thrown. Don James happy with the block, not happy with the penalty.
First and 25 back on the 34-yard line of Oregon.
And again, the block came on Oregon's right side. And it's been blocked on that side all three times, last week and this week.
So it's first and 10. Just check that, first and 25. Billy Joe wanting to go for all of it early. Nope, going to lay it off. Got up to Darius Turner. Turner inside the 30 and down to about the 27-yard line. Darius has only caught one ball all season, so that's his second. And one catch for 11 yards earlier. This one good for 7 yards.
So nice when you have good protection. Holbert has all day to look for a deep guy. Might as well get a big play if we can get it, but he's got enough time to recognize that the deep play isn't there and come off to your fullback just hanging around in the open area.
Second down and 18. They have to get down to the 9 for a first down, so they got some work to do. Orlando McKay out of bounds. Incomplete. This is really one of the more interesting aspects of the game, and that is Keith Gilbertson, the offensive coordinator from Snohomish for Washington. The defensive coordinator, Denny Shuler, from Snohomish. They grew up together for Oregon. Okay, they're going against each other. So you've got two guys that are literally brothers going head-to-head right now.
Well, and they were on the same staff at Utah State for 5 years, too, under Bruce Snyder.
Yep. Really having a good day here in the first half. Third down and 18. Two wide to the right, Gaspard and Bailey. McKay on the far side. Looking for McKay. Got him. Oh, incomplete. What a hit by Darryl Smith, number 20.
He probably wishes it had been Bailey, since Bailey has burned him twice for touchdowns. And poor old Orlando McKay gets the brunt of Smith's frustrations.
That's exactly right.
Again, Homer does a good job of looking away from the play and coming back. The ball is right on target. Just a good solid hit, helmet on the ball from Darryl Smith, and the ball comes out. Boom.
It now will be a field goal attempt by Washington, a 44-yard attempt by Travis Hansen. Almost dead center. Long enough. It is good. Travis Hansen with a 44-yard field goal puts him 3-for-7 for the year and his longest. The one he had made earlier, well, his longest was 43 yards against Nebraska. Huskies up by 16, and young Travis has to feel a whole lot better after that. And catch the best in college soccer action this Monday at 6 o'clock when the Portland Pilots take on the Oregon State Beavers. That's right here on Prime Sports Northwest. I'm Don Poyer along with Chuck Nelson, our good buddy Todd McKim from the Oregon Ducks, and down in Eugene Way, having a chance to spend a Saturday afternoon together here on Prime Sports. Home of the Huskies, the Ducks, the Beavers, and the Cougars. Jason Crabb. Good high kick, but short. From the 10, Burwell. Shane Falcoa closes in on him. Yeah, it may not have been. It was 27 instead of Dante Robinson. So, 10:46 remaining in the second quarter. First and 10 from the 27-yard line of Oregon.
Well, the Ducks trying to put back-to-back first downs together for the first time today. They just had one first down, just have been unable to move the football, and then even when they punted the ball, disaster has struck today as well. So they need to settle things down here. They need to move the ball a little bit to try to get some confidence.
Oregon with 33 total yards for the day. First and 10 from the 27, receivers, one on each side. Musgrave wanting to throw right away. Too far. Interception. Walter Bailey, the leader on this team in interceptions, down to the 10, out of bounds at the 9-yard line. Bailey now with 5. 31-yard return. He was overthrown by Musgrave.
And we may have flag down. A penalty in the end zone. I don't know if that's for celebration or what. But Bailey, of course, from Benson Tech in Portland, was an outstanding high school player, a tremendous athlete, won the long jump championship in the state of Oregon two consecutive years, and he has been a sensational find for Washington. Comes in, makes a great play, tried to take it in for the score, thought he was in, made a great effort, but was out of bounds at the 9, and then I think there'll probably be a penalty against the Huskies, a dead ball foul.
Talked about Oregon, and what they needed to do was not make big plays.
25. Too much celebrating in the end zone, evidently.
And you take the ball from the 9-yard line where Walter Bailey was forced out of bounds back to the 24. Don James.
Excessive celebration, indeed. Crowd loves that one.
You get two non-contact after the play fouls on three or four plays. Don James. Very important to him that his teams keep their poise, keep their character, play the game by the rules, don't try to show anybody up. He won't be happy.
Well, his problems are only penalties. Oregon's problems are interceptions, blocked punts, and a lack of offense.
If your problems are excessive celebrations, that's a lot better than throwing interceptions.
First and 24, three receivers to the left. Hober looking for one of them right now. Got a lot of time. Man wide open. Bailey, no. He was going against Chad Cota, the strong safety. Hober, and Billy had him.
Hober licking his lips there for two reasons. One, he was licking his chops. He knew he had a big play. And two, he ate half a sandwich with how much time he had back there. He's got to get those crumbs off his lips. All sorts of time. Ball just out of the reach of Mario Bailey.
See what I have to put up with, Todd, all season long? Lines like that.
Well, you're ahead 16-0, though.
I don't know. Second down at 24. McKay to the left. Bailey on the near side now with the I formation. Billy's going to throw again. Swings it off to the side. Matt Jones. And pretty good coverage by Oregon as he gets down to the 25-yard line. Only give him 1 yard. And Cota coming up, number 7, the strong safety.
He may be the best hitter in that Oregon secondary, a redshirt freshman from Ashland High School, led his team to a state championship 2 years ago, and he has no respect at all for either his body or anybody else's.
Yeah, Gritz has recruited some good kids from Lebanon, Oregon, and Ashland, Oregon.
Two very good programs.
Yeah. Third down and 23. Not been all that good a drive so far for Washington following the interception. Across the middle, McKay open. Still wrestles his way down to, they're going to call it the 11-yard line. He gets 12 yards, so it'll be fourth down. Because it was really first and goal. Yeah, originally, I should have been saying first at 24 or 25.
Well, and the defense knows that, and they just have to back up to the goal line and play everything in front of them.
And Hobart and that offense has got to hope to throw the ball short and hope one of our guys can turn it into a big play and get it into the end zone. What you do get is Travis Hansen with another shot.
And 18-yard line, call it a 28-yard attempt from the left hash mark. And it is good. And this is going to do wonders for the young man.
Frustration by the Husky offense. Two big turnovers, a blocked punt, and the interception turned into field goal attempts rather than touchdowns. But like you say, Don, what it does is you get Travis Hansen a chance to get out there and feel a little bit better about himself. You have no idea how big that 44-yard field goal he made earlier was to the psyche of a kicker who's been under the gun.
Yeah, under the gun and injured and not happy with himself, too.
Big expectations coming into the year, as everyone knows. He's the younger brother of All-American kicker Jason Hansen at Washington State.
Who is here, I believe, today watching the game.
Who I believe, because Washington State has a bye, is actually in the stadium.
In fact, I think there are a number of Huskies here. I know for a fact Drew Bledsoe's in town somewhere, their starting quarterback. And Philip Bobo, one of the receivers.
Cougars with a chance to come over and see firsthand.
That's not them. We understand that's not the Washington State.
These were some of Chuck Nelson's roommates when he was in college. Yes.
See, it's tough getting out of school and you got to make a living. You can't afford to buy a shirt.
Oh, man.
Lost in all of this, though, is the fact that Oregon defensively held, kept the Huskies out of the end zone despite two or three bad situations.
Yeah.
Again,
great
field position, and your defense comes through. You've got the number 3 defense in the conference against the pass, number 4 against the rush, but you're 6th in scoring because the other team never has to go very far.
Donovan Moore carrying and brought down by Dana Hall, number 5. Return of 8.
Another reason these Huskies are so good is the fact that the players that they have love to play. They don't care if they're covering kicks. Here you've got Dana Hall, the senior, one of the leaders of the defense, says, hey, I'm going to cover kicks and I'm going to make big plays. A lot of teams, you get guys that don't want to do that.
That says it all. First and 10 now. They keep it on the ground to Burwell, but he is brought down by Dave Hoffman, number 54. Nice unassisted tackle as the linebacker sniffed that one out and got into the backfield.
Also notice that Tommy Smith is back in the ballgame, number 15, as a safety. He was injured, went out with what looked like a shoulder problem, but he's back in. But a great play by Hoffman there. The linemen up front for Washington, the philosophy is you folks up front wipe out the offensive line and the linebackers make the tackles, and that's exactly what happened.
Well, Randy Hart, their coach, even says our defense doesn't begin until we're all 2 yards into the backfield. This explains numbers like this. Second down and 11, here comes pressure. They get it over to Brown in time and a first down for Oregon. Nice play by Musgrave. Good job by Brown of reading the blitz, too.
Got inside Walter Bailey. Musgrave puts the ball out where Mr. Brown could get to it. With a close-up look at Doug Musgrave, he throws it on his way backwards.
It's okay.
But it's in the right spot.
Marco and Bailey on top. And Bailey is injured. Bailey was on the bottom of the two Huskies on the play against Brown.
when you've got the safety closing from the other side, sometimes you get hurt more by your own people. When you've got you and the receiver are going in the same direction and that safety's closing as fast as he can from coming in the other direction. See, it must be a neck injury of some sort. They've asked Walter Bailey to make sure his legs can move. You can see Walter Bailey closing here, and here comes Shane Palkoa. Boom. Shane Palkoa delivers the blow to Walter Bailey up around the neck and shoulders. See a better angle here. Boom. Just compress that neck, compress that head.
Could have gotten the wind knocked out of him too, but more than likely a wrap to the side of the head, much like we saw Nick Barsala, the linebacker for California last week against Washington. That time it was Jay Berry's knee catching Barsala's head.
When you talk about depth, out goes Walter Bailey, and in comes a former starter, William Doctor.
That's right, who has been a settling factor on various occasions coming into this game or this season. Burwell again, they test Doctor's side. Not much there as Palkoa comes up well. Hillary Butler also playing, and DeMarco Farr, number 75. And Tommy Smith. The whole right side came over.
Not much there because, again, that speed of the Husky defense. Juan Shedrick with a great block on Donald Jones at the point of attack. And Burwell looks like he has room to ramble, but only 10 yards total today. Only a couple on that play.
He only needs 161 yards to tie number 10 Mel Renfro for career yards. We all remember Mel wanting to go deep. Musgrave, he was feeling the heat and decided to dump it out in front of Ronnie Harris out of trouble.
And that's what Rich Brooks likes to see.
Instead of trying to hang in there and hang in there and hang in there, just throw the thing away if nobody's open after 3 seconds.
We'd much rather have third and seven than an interception, third and 12,
right.
Turnover, because you're taking shots from those Donald Jones and Andy Mason and Steve Emptman.
Is it me or is it getting colder up here, guys? It's third down and 8. Not all that warm down there for Mr. Musgrave right now either. 7:17 remaining in the second quarter. 3 receivers right. We might have a Husky in there too soon as they try to go out to Harris on the right side. Boy, I could have sworn. Yeah, okay, flag did go down.
Donald Jones getting a little excited there. Got those ears pinned back a little too tight.
See, in track, he would be disqualified. He wouldn't be able to compete anymore because you only get one false start. But in football, you come back and you just get 5-yard penalty and you get another down.
All you Oregon guys, they all they want to talk about is track.
Yeah.
I tell you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that or Terrell Brandon when he was playing basketball. Now, you know, we're back to track.
See, Donald Jones at the top of your screen gets that head start on Todd Gettison. Can't do that.
Nope. Third down and 3. So now you go back and look at that incompletion, and it's even a better move by Musgrave. Third and 3, 2 receivers right. Still going to throw, could get it himself. He got it. First down, Oregon. Nice play by Doug Musgrave. Reggie Reaser with the tackle. Got a lot of backup people in there defensively now for Washington. Brett Collins also in there playing for Jaime Fields at the outside linebacker spot.
Talk about depth as a starter, captain, second team all Pac-10.
But Todd, yeah. I can remember when these kids were all redshirt freshmen playing and getting, you know, the lunch handed to them as they learned on their way up, but it's paid off. The dividends are there. First and 10. Keeping it down there. Tommy Smith back there waiting for Burwell. Surprised there wasn't a piling on call, tell you the truth. Tommy Smith, though, with great penetration, getting in there almost the same time the ball did. Loss of 6 yards.
Defense is designed to cause disruption before anybody can think about how to react. You can see Tommy Smith just busts it, gets inside Brandon Jumper before the block can be made.
5-yard loss officially.
Makes it tough for those running backs to set up a move when all they can do is get the ball and go down.
Musgrave looks at 2nd and 15 on his own 45. Got a man open, but behind, well behind, Brian Brown, number 80.
That play in trouble from the get-go. Oregon trying to set up a pick play on the outside, and between the Washington defenders and the Oregon receivers. Just a big pile up about 5 yards downfield. Musgrave again threw it someplace where nobody was going to get it. At least it's not a loss. You talk about this Washington defense, and one of your main goals, as Rich Brooks says, is we're not so much worried about gaining yards as we are even getting back to the line of scrimmage. An incomplete pass, at least it gets you back to the line of scrimmage.
Well, on first down, they force a 5-yard loss, and you're in a long situation again.
Third down and 15. Huskies this year only giving up third down conversions at a 29% clip. Third and 15, trips to the right side. Here comes the pressure. Laying it off to Donovan Moore, and net right there. Dana Hall, number 5, after the heat by Collins and Fields, the two outside LBs.
And a play that could have worked if not for Smith's speed and anticipation. He got through and around the blockers. Watch the blockers set up to the left side of the screen. And Heath, nice right through there before Heath Howington can put a hand on him. And that disrupted the entire play. Moore never had a chance.
That is a textbook tackle, too. Back to punt is Thompson. And this has been an adventure today.
You see some smoke coming out of those Husky helmets as they line up to rush the Duck punt team.
This time he gets it away. It's a good one. Bryant takes it back on his own 11-yard line and called the fair catch. So Thompson, a deep sigh, got it away, and it was a good punt of 42 yards and no return. 5:10 remaining here in the first half, and the Huskies lead it 19-0.
Yeah, sports and beer.
Gotta do it. Figure we get like 10 of these in a row.
All right,
yeah, get this. Like
right.
They do it. How do
okay.
They do it? Okay. Ooh, like that.
Right, calm down.
He's doing it.
Yeah.
Oh, look. Maybe we could slow it down.
Yeah.
Yeah, watch. Oh, no, wait.
Okay, that's not it.
All right, the slam dunk.
Slam dunks are cool.
Oh.
Oh!
Pretty cool, huh?
Mildred. 5:10 remaining. Don Poyer, Chuck Nelson, Todd McKim. First down. Jay Berry gets the call for the Huskies, who gets it out to about the 10-yard line. Gain of 3. Eric Castle, one of them in there. Defensively, along with Joe Farwell, number 51. Farwell with 48 tackles coming in to this contest. I don't know if we touched on it, but the last 3 weeks he's been playing in games with literally no practice during the week because of his bad ankle. Second down and 7. Matt Jones. Not much there. They try to bang their way out.
Field position like this, and you've got over 300 pounds a man on that offensive line. Billy Joe Hobert goes in the huddle and says, "Fellas, we're a lot bigger than they are. We're not going to try to do anything fancy. You knock your guys down, we'll just tuck our helmets up there under your shirts and up in the shoulder pads and follow you forward. Let's get some room to operate."
A lot different philosophy than when they had the ball in Oregon territory, even though they were faced with first and 25 or so, they had to throw the ball in.
That's the day so far, the work of these gentlemen. Now on third down and 2. First down, Berry can keep it going all the way out to the 35-yard line. Cota had a shot at him, number 7, and is finally brought down after he picks up 15.
3 consecutive running plays to get the ball out of their own end. See some backups in there on the offensive line, but it makes no difference. Andy Peterson pulls on the play. Jay Berry has first down yardage before he even has to elude Castle. Able to come up with a little bit more.
Berry now with 58 yards. That's what he had last week. And he's doing well now. First and 10, ball on the 35. Everybody spread out across the field, and kabang on Mario Bailey. My, Eric Castle with a riveting hit right at where Bailey needed to get for the first down. We'll see. Crowd giving him a hand after he gets up from that crunching hit.
You see, Mario Bailey goes around Andy Connor, just settles in the area between the linebacker Connor and in front of Eric Castle, the safety. Castle comes up and delivers the blow, and a little sandwich job with Castle and Connor. Bailey in the middle, but it is a Husky first down.
from the 46, Castle with two interceptions this year. That one overthrown, intended for Orlando McKay and defended by Muhammad Oliver.
The old loosen him up trick.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a keep him honest pass.
Well, especially when your guy has just gotten the knocked out of him up in front. It says, if those guys are going to close that fast, I'm going to try to loosen them up and make them think deep a little bit. Mario Bailey will come back to the huddle and say thank you.
How is Don James going to convince Mario Bailey to go across the middle, though, as a decoy again so they can go deep?
Well, 2 years ago, Mario Bailey wouldn't have made that catch.
That's exactly right.
That's how much he's improved. He's making the tough catches, and he's got a lot more courage.
Second down and 10. McKay to the near side with Bailey and Gaspar to the left. Going to McKay for the little quick opener to midfield, right at the 50. They still need five more yards for the first down. Clock ticking away, 3:06 here in the first half. Washington leading 19-0. Good to have you with us here on Prime Sports Northwest. What if they'll run us both nights, Sunday night and Monday night both?
Residuals?
Yeah. They will. Michael Odino, our producer-director, just confirmed that.
That last play, a direct result of the previous play. Orlando McKay goes deep, so we got him thinking deep. Let's hit it right in front. Take our five.
And it's third down and five. One-on-one. McKay against Oliver. Looks like Oliver won. Interception for Muhammad Oliver, number 11. That's his first of the year. Great play by the left corner, the senior.
Man-to-man coverage, and Oliver was the man. William Hobart saw it was man-to-man and checked off to this play. The ball just underthrown. If you're going to throw this route, you've got to throw it out where Orlando McKay and his speed can make the play. The defender has got to think about the ball. He's got to get out of his break. Orlando McKay tries to make a play.
Well,
but Muhammad Oliver has inside position on an underthrown pass for that route.
Billy did not do exactly what Musgrave did. Keep it
on the outside shoulder.
That's right. First and 10 for Oregon. Good play by Oliver. Ball on the 22 with 2:26 left here in the first half, and a flag goes down. Looks like some motion on the folks in white jerseys.
Looked like John Tattersall, Oregon's left offensive guard, in his haste to get into a tackler, got off the line a little bit too quick.
So they'll have to back it
Dead
up.
Ball start on the offense. Well, the timer put 3 seconds back on the clock. Three seconds
back up on the wall as Rich Brooks in his 15th year. He came into the conference same time Terry Donahue did. They both came in 2 years after Don James did, which made Don James, well, he was in the league maybe 3 years, and they called him the dean of the Pac-10 coaches because everybody'd left.
Has the respect of just about everybody around the country.
Yes.
Always mentioned and one of those coaches that can get the most out of his talent.
Well, they're always
competitive.
And whenever there's a big opening somewhere, they're saying, well, what about Rich Brooks? What about Rich Brooks? What about him, Todd? Is he happy where he's at?
His family is happy. He's got a good situation in Oregon in that the expectations until this year haven't been that high. But he's real competitive. He'd like to have this football team a little bit better.
First and 15, and of course the injuries decimated this team this year. It's hard to coach against injuries, real hard. Good pressure by Steve Emptman on the pass. It's incomplete, intended for Brian Brown, and covered by Dana Hall. But they've got new facilities now. I mean, Autzen Stadium is a wonderful place for football. That's not the new facility. The administration.
Yeah,
that is wonderful. Out adjacent to the stadium.
Big, huge weight room. I think it's maybe the second largest weight room in the country. Nebraska might be the biggest one. Musgrave has done so many things that are not going to show up in the stat sheet that I think have pleased Rich Brooks today. He showed poise when he's made a bad play. It's been a bad play that the Huskies couldn't capitalize on. He's made good decisions.
Second down at 15. Musgrave has three receivers to the right side, keeps it on the ground. And Burwell doesn't get much. Tanaka Smith, number 55, one of the folks on top of him after a two-yard gain. So it'll be third and very long with 2:11 remaining in the first half. Keep in mind, coin toss was won by Oregon, and they deferred, so they'll have their choice to do whatever starting the third quarter.
At this point,
they won't elect to punt.
I guarantee you that. Well, I'm just thinking about the win, too. But they're going to want the ball.
With under 2 minutes to go in the half, too, they'd be perfectly content. They don't care whether they get outside the 20. Let's just hang on to it for the rest of the half.
They're down in 12. Draw to Burwell. Boom. Steve Emptman. Swatting at him like flies. Emptman is so big and so strong. Incredible player. Got a timeout called by Washington with a minute 31 remaining.
What, number 90 come in from the left of your screen?
Just throws him down.
So much mayhem being caused up front. You've got crossing patterns and the loopers and tackles, and everybody's going different directions.
And how many
you come
guys
out of that pile, and all of a sudden you got 300 pounds of number 90.
But this man was almost on his knees, and he still threw Burwell down. And Burwell is not exactly chopped liver at 190 pounds. My goodness.
Well, the Oregon coach has said this week, in particular offensive line coach Neil Zimbukas, that if a defensive lineman should ever win the Heisman Trophy, Steve Entman's the guy. He's that good. He's the best football player in the country in a year in which there aren't that many outstanding offensive players.
I would concur. I agree.
The only defensive player continually mentioned in USA Today, as for one publication, as a potential Heisman candidate.
Fourth down. Thompson back to punch, and he's back on his 8-yard line. Look out for the pressure. Dean O'Brien, midfield, ooh. Shane Falcoa getting dangerously close. I don't know where he thinks he's going, but
I think he thought one of the Huskies might have touched
it. Maybe, yeah, maybe. Falcoa got very close. So it'll be Husky ball on the 45 of Washington with a minute 20 to work with.
Hey, he gave it a shot. What
he
the
did.
Heck?
Hey, those guys from Eatonville.
Brandon
they like
Jumper.
In the end zone.
Well, Brandon, 35 is Brandon Jumper, by the way, out of Eatonville. And remember, he led the state in scoring up here as a senior in high school.
He knows where the end zone is.
That's right.
Any
Brandon.
Chance he gets. You see open field, I'm going to pick it up and go.
Well, that's just it. He hasn't scored a touchdown for the Ducks.
Hasn't scored one this year. There's my chance. And they're just clarifying on the field that the ball was not touched by the receiving team. 33-yard punt by Thompson. First and 10 from the 45. Three receivers left. Holbert. Look out. Banderson's got him. What an individual effort by Romeo Banderson. That's his third sack of the year. Actually, he may have been in on a couple earlier today.
Banderson just pushing Chris Wrong and back into Billy Joe Hover. Billy trying to backpedal out of the way. Couldn't backpedal fast enough.
Second and 10. Got another flag down as they complete one to Mario Bailey. And official McKim up here is saying it's a hold.
Well, that's what they're
more
indicating.
More than likely, yeah.
Well, now the Husky philosophy in this situation has completely changed. The heck with going for some more points. Let's try to now run out the clock. And so now it's Oregon that will be offensive with its timeouts.
Right.
To try to get the ball around midfield and maybe get something on the board before the half ends.
Remember, this holding penalty will be marked off from the spot of the foul, which was in the Husky backfield. So you got one sack on first down, on your first down. Chris Wrong and the man who gave up the sack on the previous play once again on Vanison just absolutely hauls him down. Not a tough call for anybody in a striped shirt to make.
Tell you, if this keeps up, we're going to be in Ballard before long with these penalties ever since the punt.
Got to wait for him to open the locks.
Can't go much farther left, folks. Second down and 41. And another flag down as Jay Berry gets the call up to the 20, but I think it might have been Terrell Edwards getting in there a little too soon.
Anytime you see a defensive man pointing at an offensive man, you know it's the defensive guy that moved. Terrell Edwards there trying to put the finger on Mala Mala. Don James thinking this is going to be the longest minute and a half end of a half that he's ever seen. Three penalties, three consecutive plays.
Well, to show you what Oregon's done today defensively, despite the fact the Huskies have 19 points, that's the second sack Oregon has had, or at least the earlier sack by Brandt.
Yeah,
it was the second sack, and the Huskies have only given up four all year.
Mm-hmm. Two of those last week.
That's right.
So doesn't happen very often. You get a look here on the right of your screen, indeed, number 60, Andy Peterson.
Kind like of a bunch of guys.
Resets, does a little shake and bake, put it to music, and you got a hit.
He's just a redshirt freshman out of Port Orchard. South Kitsap High School. Boy, did they grow
dead
big.
Ball. Ball start on the offense. Repeat first down.
Goes against Washington. I was only kidding about the Ballard stuff.
Let's not take this seriously.
Yeah. Now we're inside the 10 with 47 seconds to go. You're right. Don James just wants to get into the locker room now.
Well, he's getting closer.
He's almost there. Okay.
You set him up.
Bada boom, bada bing, right?
Where do I set him up?
Second down and 46 yards to go. 47 seconds to go. Oregon does have three timeouts left. They're thinking field position. Scott said they're going to start calling timeouts between plays unless they give up a big one.
Maybe they ought to think score. You know, you make a big play here instead of waiting for a fourth, third down, or fourth down to make a big play.
Well, you know they're going to be sending people, because even if you send people through every gap, you've got to have a blitz. You know they've got a blitz that fills every gap, and even a running play is going to get stuffed.
Yeah, Oregon's defense has got to feel pretty good right now as far as, well, two things. One is field position, and two, as Todd alluded to, is that there's only 19 points on that board.
They put 53 seconds on the board, and if I remember correctly, the Huskies had 52 seconds when the first play of this drive started.
Minute 20.
Yeah,
minute 20 when they get the ball.
52 seconds after the second play, so I'm not sure exactly what's happened with the clock.
They added some more.
I think once you get over 40 yards, you've got more than 40 yards for a first down, and start adding time.
Second and 46. Matt Jones fights his way out to about the 17 as Andy Connor is dragging behind but makes the tackle.
The Huskies in no hurry, but the Ducks will stop the clock. Get there.
Ducks still have two remaining.
Get as many snaps as they can in before the half on either side of the ball. They're trying to get the ball back, or
hey guys,
Washington makes a mistake.
It's third down, and the Huskies need to get to the Oregon 45 for a first down.
If the wind is at their back,
then they're at their own 15.
That's no wind at all right now. Isn't that strange?
Yeah. Don James, 17th year, is 11-3 against Rich Brooks. Some of the games from this series. Yeah, this is the last 5 years.
Home team winning on every occasion.
Yeah, they've split the last four. And this series, where it may not be the yelling type of intense series like a Washington-Washington State, it is, though, one of the most physical series or rivalries I've ever seen. You ever want to see some incredible hitting, and this goes back into the 50s and 60s, Washington against Oregon. Never fail.
We've seen a couple people go down for the Huskies today, something we haven't seen very often.
After the game, it's third down and 39. Berry. And Cote is there along with Bambison again. My goodness. What a play. And another timeout by Oregon, of course. 38 seconds remaining. First half. Brooks and Douglas, and the Ducks down 19-0.
Well, now the Ducks maybe can go for a blocked punt in this situation. They blocked one against Utah in the fourth quarter. Doug Douglas made the block, and it gave Oregon an opportunity to potentially win that game against Utah. They did not. But where the ball is placed right now, the Huskies will be punting inside their own 15-yard line. The ball is actually hit, so you've got a choice. Do you try for a long return with Brian Brown? The Ducks have not had a long return this year. Their longest is only 15 yards. Or do you try to go for the block? And, of course, you take the chance that maybe you're off the punter and you give up a first down and not give yourself any chance with the football.
Setting it up for you. 38 seconds remaining. Wardell, John Wardell, back to punt. And he will be on his 12. John punted very well against California.
Has all year, averaging 44 and a half yards per punt, filling in for or taking over for Bridge Over, beating out.
Brian Brown back to receive on his 35. Let's see, we got 10 people for Oregon coming on the rush. Wobbly punch. Brown stays in bounds at the 40. Gets up to his 46-yard line. And there are 29 ticks on the old clock remaining here in the second quarter.
Good job by Brian Brown there. Just get the ball and get what you can get. Don't try to do anything fancy.
And you don't have to get out of bounds because the clock is going to stop on the change of possession anyway. So might as well take it and get as much as you can.
You got 8 yards on the 38-yard punt. netted out at 30. 29 seconds. So three receivers come out to the left side for Musgrave. They're on their 46. Let's see what the Ducks can come up with. Wants to go to the other side as Jones. Good. Down to the Husky 38-yard line. Just inside the 38, and it's a first down.
Good scheme by the Oregon offense there. Jones one-on-one with Chico Fraley, a linebacker, wide receiver on a linebacker.
The red zone, meaning they have not allowed anyone to run a play from scrimmage inside their own 20-yard line. Now, Cal scored last week, but they didn't run anything from inside the Husky 20. Closest they got was the 22, 23-yard line. First and 10 from the 38. Same formation as Burwell to the right side. They go to Thomas in the tight end, and Dave Hoffman knocks it away. Thomason with his third pass deflection this year. 18 seconds remaining in the quarter. Keep Thomas in mind, they got a great kicker, too, for Oregon with Greg McCallum.
They could get some points on the board. The Huskies have only given up 3 points at home all year.
In this quarter?
No, in three full games at home.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Second down. And they need 10. Option, Burwell. Fumble! Dana Hall's got it. And he'll be hauled down there at the 41 with 7 seconds remaining.
Well, that was a great hit, but a bad decision by Burwell. If he had cut earlier, he had a lane. Instead, he was indecisive. The tackle was made. He loses the football, and Oregon's scoring opportunity. Now, you tell me, do you think he can cut this ball inside behind Tattersall 64?
Sure.
Yes. Instead, he runs into the tackle.
Either that or give him the leg inside and then go outside.
And I think that has to do with the fact he hasn't been able to practice much. He is rusty. But you got to give Hoffman credit, too. He was right there, beat the block, and made a big hit.
Hoffman, that is the third time he has caused a fumble, and that's the first recovery for Dana Hall. Not all that many turnovers, really, in this game so far. One play. They're going to go for it all. Orlando McKay. Oh, he got his hands on it. No time remaining.
Well, he wouldn't have gotten into the end zone, but it would have looked awfully good on the stat sheets.
And the highlight reel,
too. Yeah, recruiting tape, but it would look good. Hey, that's going to do it for the first half in this Northwest rivalry between Oregon and Washington. 19-0. The Huskies, third ranked in the country and undefeated. But they got plenty of hits and plenty of effort on the part of the Oregon Ducks against them in the first half. No question about it. We'll be back with first half highlights and stats in just a minute. For the third-ranked Washington Huskies over their cousins to the south, the Oregon Ducks, in this typical Northwest rivalry game. Don Foyer, Chuck Nelson, Todd McKim. And it's been an interesting first half. I've enjoyed it, tell you the truth, guys. It could have been a lot worse. It could have been Oregon, I think, is playing a very, I want to say classy, heady first half, in the fact that it could be a lot worse in terms of scoring and just simple mistakes made by Oregon.
Well, the Huskies broke out quickly with two scoring passes from Hobart to Bailey, and that set the tone for the day. And then Oregon's special teams broke down twice. The Huskies blocked two punts, resulted in two field goals for Washington. Oregon offensively hasn't been able to move the ball with any consistency, and so it's kind of gone according to form so far.
Yeah, the injuries are really telling as far as Oregon, Chuck.
Well, that Oregon defense, though, which is one of the areas that they've had a lot of injuries, the defensive line specifically, has played pretty well. Washington has had three drives in the first half that resulted in negative yardage. So the defense, even though they're not getting very good field position, they've been playing well with what they've had.
Good scheme by Denny Schuler from Snohomish.
Isn't that a surprise? Yeah. One of the best around.
Let's look at the highlights now. It's really the Mario Bailey show in the first half. Two touchdown passes. This was the first one on man-to-man coverage against Darrell Smith.
Once again, Billy Joe Hobart just throws the ball out where Mario Bailey can make a play, and he's just turned into an incredible athlete, a big play receiver for Washington. That's his 10th career touchdown. That tied it for the school record in a single season.
And then he had a second one going the other direction in the second quarter.
And that, of course, broke the school record for most touchdown receptions in a season. Once again, man-to-man, a perfect throw from Billy Joe Hobart to put the Huskies on top 13-0 with the missed extra point.
Another positive for the Huskies has been the kicking of Travis Hanson. This, a 44-yard field goal.
Taking a lot of heat over the course of this season. 2 for 6 coming into the game, 44 yards, his first attempt. Not an easy kick under any circumstances, but when you spend the whole week reading about, you're
the only negative on this whole football team. When you can go out and answer those questions to a certain degree, you've got to feel good about it. And he responded with a second one later on.
Let's look statistically now at the first two quarters of play and total yards. Washington with 196 to 75 for the Ducks. Turnovers, a couple, as Todd alluded to earlier. Penalties on Washington, two of those coming after play. One, excessive celebration, they called it, in the end zone after the interception by Walter Bailey. And then another one, just a personal foul on another takeaway. You're right. You agree. Okay. Really pretty much as planned, as we thought. The 196 to 75 especially. 18 rushing yards for Oregon, and the beat goes on for that Washington defense for sure.
But only 72 yards rushing for Washington. So, again, that Oregon defense holding the Washington rushing game well in check.
Okay. Todd, anything?
Well, Washington's defense has been dominating, obviously. Yep. Oregon has run a total of three plays in Washington territory, one for negative yardage, one was a fumble, and the other was just a minimal gain. So they just haven't been able to put anything together offensively to try to move that ball against maybe the best defense in the country.
And remember, Doug Musgrave, his first start ever, major college football at quarterback, and he's going against that number one team defensively in the nation. All right, second half coming up. We'll have it for you right here at Husky Stadium in just a minute. Stay with us. John Poyer, Chuck Nelson, Todd McKim. And Oregon, as expected, chose to receive here in the third quarter after deferring on the coin toss at the beginning of the game. Some of the Oregon cheerleaders made it up for the game. A lot of Oregon fans in the closed end of the field. Crab's boot, another high one. From inside the 10. And a flag goes down back on the 20. After the carry by Burwell.
Things picking up right where they left off. Yellow hankies all over the field.
Tripped up by Walter Bailey.
And we've got a hold on the return team for Oregon. The Oregon possession so far. Two block punts. Those turning into points. The interception.
You can see the starting point of those drives, too. Their own 13, their own 23. Only one drive starting outside their own 27-yard line. And even that one was still in their own end.
And word has it, yes, indeed, there he is. Kyle Croston in at quarterback now at 6'2", 194 pounds, redshirt freshman, a broken finger. He's out of Vancouver. And on first down, they go to Shedrick, the fullback. Broken finger for Doug Musgrave, evidently. My goodness sakes, that's the third injured quarterback for Oregon this year, Todd.
It is unbelievable. It's bad enough, or tough enough, to try to beat Washington with your best personnel. But when you are now playing a guy who 2 weeks ago was a backup free safety, they moved him to defense.
And who is the backup quarterback at this point?
Bobby Brothers, a wide receiver who was a quarterback through his first 3 years.
So your top two quarterbacks are guys that up until a couple of weeks ago weren't quarterbacks.
Second down and six. Croston is the quarterback, and he'll roll out and throw. Got a receiver. Ronnie Harris couldn't hold on. It would have been good for the first down. Musgrave was 6 of 13 for 57 yards. And one interception, not bad for your first collegiate start.
And in all honesty, he probably showed more poise in the first two quarters of this game than maybe any of the other quarterbacks has shown over any extended period of time in any of the other games. Danny O'Neill had some good games at Texas Tech, Washington State, but he also made some bad decisions. I don't think Musgrave made more than maybe one or two bad decisions.
Maybe 6 for 15 is all, but the plays that he didn't make sometimes are the ones that are big.
They're down and six as Jones goes in motion. So two receivers to the right now. Looking downfield and deep, he's got Jones, but overthrows Anthony. And Shane Palcoa was defending for the Huskies. So it'll be fourth down for the Ducks. And Tommy Thompson will come out to handle the punting chores.
Well, you look at Croston, a very good athlete. And on the second play of that series, we saw what Oregon probably will do more of, and that's roll him out. He can roll out. He's much better on the roll than, say, a Musgrave is.
And not a bad way to go against a Husky defense that likes to send a lot of people, try to avoid as many as possible, but making them come and get you.
Yeah, you buy time, and you can see more of the field. 10-man showing a rush now for the Huskies as Thompson is back on his three. Good protection. Wobbly punt. Bryant at the duck 48. Trying to get to the fence. Goes up the inside. Now out. Can't come up with it, though. A return of 12. As Willie Tate, a backup tight end, made the tackle.
Contrast these starting points from Washington possessions with the graphic we saw previously of the Oregon possessions. Last five possessions starting in Oregon territory, well inside Oregon territory. Good job. Look at the results by the Oregon defense. No touchdowns of any drive starting in the Oregon end of the field.
Four out of eight drives they score.
10 yards from the previous spot. First down.
The beat goes on.
Goodness sakes, another penalty.
This
on
time,
the defensive unit, that being Washington.
And this, the holding penalty took place before the ball was punted, so it is a first down for Oregon. The Husky defense comes back on the field. The Oregon offense goes back on the field. Once again, it's not just the penalties themselves, but it's the timing of the penalties.
Well, okay, the penalty, they call it on the defensive team. So it was enough yardage for the first guy.
Before, if the holding penalty takes place before the ball is punted,
they're still on defense.
Then you're still considered a defensive penalty.
And possession had not changed yet. So it's first and 10 for Oregon.
Take them any way you can get them.
Ball on the 27. Burwell. Little off tackle play. Jaime Fields, one of the first to get him and slow him down anyway. Not until Burwell picked up 4 yards. Burwell coming in averaged 104 yards a game in four games, but he's averaging 4.5 yards per carry. And he's only a sophomore, technically. Today, he has 16 of Oregon's total of 26 yards rushing. So it's second down and 6. Two receivers sent to the right side. Huskies, look at that. They got 9 people up on the line. Burstyn still with it. Pressure. Got a man. Ronnie Harris tipped. Intercepted by Palcoa after the tip by Dana Hall. Palcoa trying to make a nifty move, gets around Jones, gets another block down to the 31-yard line before he is brought down by Heath Howington. Palcoa's second interception of the year and a 32-yard return.
Athleticism.
Tip
right there.
Tip drill
on a ball that was just a little bit underthrown. If Croston lays it out all the way, it might be a touchdown because Jones had Hall beat by about a yard and a half. Great play.
Another factor to remember, Dana Hall, 6'3". That's an awful big corner. He's got those long arms. That ball might not be underthrown if he's only 5'10".
On the toss sweep, Bean O'Brien trying to get away from the pursuit, but Terrell Edwards holds on to one of those ankles and brings him down. Gain of only 3.
Jones did have Dana Hall beat on the play, but Hall's athleticism and those long arms allow him to close the play, close the gap, and get the ball in the air. Palcoa turns it into a big play, a 32-yard gain.
Billy Joe looking at 2nd and 7. The quick rhythm pass going to Bailey, has the first down, down to the 20-yard line.
Mario Bailey.
Good tackle by Herman O'Berry there. Mario Bailey, for those of you that have seen Washington play quite a bit this year, has made a lot of touchdowns on plays very similar to that. Joe Homer just playing catch, 3-step drop, get it out there. Mario Bailey again tries the old spinorama move he's been so successful with this year. This time he goes outside. O'Berry feeling good to keep it out of the end zone.
1st and 10. Bryant gets the call, does some bobbing and weaving. Gary Williams on top of him as he goes down, and Joe Farwell, number 51.
Well, the Huskies have not really run the ball effectively today. They're averaging under 3 yards a carry today. So Oregon's front three, and we talked about them, inexperienced, all young guys, have done a very nice job. But, boy, how long can you hold up when an opponent is starting to drive at the 30-yard line?
Well, that and, yeah, field position has been a lot of, or a big reason for that. Trying to go outside. Bryant, pretty good pursuit. And Oregon staying home as Oliver, Muhammad Oliver, along with Paul Rodriguez, make the play. Gain of only 1 yard. Rodriguez, a backup to Chad Cota at strong safety.
And Rodriguez was the starter at that position through the first three games of the year, but they felt they had to get Cota on the field. Just too good of an athlete, too good of a football player to keep him on the pine.
All of the Tommy Smith scenario, they had to get him into the That's game. Right. Too good a player. Third down and six for Washington. Ball on the 16 of Oregon. Three receivers left side. Three Omigo. And signed by Holbert. Across the middle. Oh, nearly intercepted by Oliver. Right through his hands and a Husky receiver. Looks at his hands like, what happened?
You betrayed me, he says. The ball that shouldn't have been thrown. Ticked off. Everybody ran around into the end zone. No place to throw it. You can see that Oliver gets the first shot at it, gets two hands on it. McKay cannot react to it quickly enough as the ball changes flight.
Billy was looking all the way, too.
See an awful lot of ducks around those Huskies. No place to go.
Travis Hansen attempting a 33-yard field goal. He's 2 for 2 for the afternoon. And this one is good.
See what confidence can do. That ball flew a lot better than anything else he's hit in the first 6 weeks of the season. His third of the ball game.
Count them up. 44, 28, and 38-yard field goals by the young sophomore Travis Hansen. We'll be back in just a moment. 33 seconds remaining here in the third quarter. 22-0 after that 33-yard field goal by Travis Hansen. He's on a roll today. He's 3 for 3. And Jason Crabb back to kick off. Burwell. And just goes out of bounds inside the 5.
Well, if they take the ball at the 35, that'll be their second best starting field position of the game. So why not take it?
I was waiting for Todd to say that.
And indeed they will.
Well.
Makes sense to me.
Rich Brooks is a smart man.
Must be a history buff.
That's right.
Travis Hansen with 3 field goals today, having more productive today than he's been all year. Only 2 coming into the day. Added 3 more today. Take him up to 5 for 9 on the year. Huskies as a team.
First and 10 now from the 35. Burwell goes in motion this time. Grossman is the quarterback. And Chico Fraley follows Burwell right back in, and we got a flag thrown on the pile. Well, we got a face mask.
Another flag thrown towards the end of the play. Looks like it'll be on the Husky defense. A nice play by Chico Fraley.
3 yard loss. Now let's see what it.
Flag is a face mask. Another penalty on that Husky defense.
Well, that was a well-designed play run at the wrong time, in that they run a screen when the Huskies were in man-to-man. If they run this when, there you see the penalty right there on the face mask. If they run that when Huskies are in a zone, then you got a little better chance.
You see Greg Phillips, the center, supposed to pick off Fraley, but he could not adjust quickly enough. Fraley with good speed for a linebacker.
So they repeat. All right, it'll be 1st down and 5. Scoreboard at 2nd down. So it'll be 1st and 5. It was a quick face mask move by Fraley, but not quick enough. So Jones will be split wide to the left. Looks like man-to-man coverage. Of course, it usually is for the corners for Washington. Burwell, and nothing doing. Looks like Tyrone Rogers was in there undermining. And James Clifford. Burwell having a tough go of it today, as has every other running back against the Washington Huskies this year. I'm trying to think. Derrick Brown in Nebraska, so-so. Russell White was well contained. Lindsey Chapman's probably had the best day of anybody all year.
Majority of that was one play.
68-yard
touchdown run to tie it up for Cal in the first quarter, just towards the end of the third quarter.
Second and six, they lose one. Croston wants to throw. Got some room now as he tries to get outside, and in closes Dana Hall and two others. Palcoa. Looks like might have been Walter Bailey down there, too. Dana Hall covering a lot of real estate today.
Well, that's what Croston can do right there. He didn't see anything open. Good coverage in the secondary, so he tucks the ball in and takes off. And he's got good speed. Probably the best athlete amongst the four quarterbacks that started the season for the Ducks. It's not open. Boom. Take it. Get what you can.
Third down. They only need two. Need to get out just across the 45. Fumble by Croston, and he is met there immediately by Clifford. James Clifford, number 53. Good reaction by James. Again, you talk about that depth, Todd. Here's a guy that led the Pac-10 in tackles 2 years ago, and he's a backup to Dave Hoffman.
He comes in the game against Toledo. The first series he comes into the game, the first three plays, two That's tackles, right. and a fumble recovery.
That's right. Here's Randy. Randy Hart. There is a man like, he feels like he's living in a candy store. He's the defensive line coach for the Huskies. Fourth down, Thompson back to punt. See if Dean O'Brien can spring one. 10 people up on the rush for Washington. Ooh, high snap. Wobbly punt. Could be turning. Trying to get to that ball. Oh, he's got a lot of white jerseys. Oh, the Cardinals sin. Can he get around? No, he's not going to make it. Number four, Herman O'Berry. Stayed with him. You could see what Vino was trying to do.
You could also see that he wasn't going to be able to do it.
It was also one step forward and two back.
See, out here, outside the 20-yard line, trying to make something happen, Herman O'Berry with good enough speed to not allow Vino get around the corner.
Vino the angle on him,
gets
yeah.
put into the back penalty, and you end up back on your own 6 yard line.
That's a return of minus 17 yards.
It's not not good for Vino's nationally ranked punt return average, but it also helps that net punting average for Oregon.
Matt Jones out of bounds on a play designed to get maybe five or six.
Once again, the Huskies backed up in their own end. We're just going to run the ball and try to get ourselves some room. Matt Jones not happy with just getting a little bit of room. Once again, the cutback that Darius Turner was so successful with last year, that Oregon pursuit all goes the other way. Matt Jones gets outside. Eric Castle drags him down from behind. And, oh, do the Huskies have room to operate now.
35-yard run by Matt Jones. First to 10 now on the 48. Dean O'Brien. And he is met by number 50, Salila Malapai. I'll get it right.
Well, Jones is one of those guys, of course, that hails from the state of Oregon. So you know he enjoyed that run from Central Catholic with the state player of the year. And,
that's right.
You know, he doesn't get a chance to get many opportunities to play against Oregon. He wants to make the most of it today.
Washington with a ways to go to get up to their... to their average.
A lot of time left. Hobert to Curtis Gaspard spins around Muhammad Oliver.
It's interesting to see if Bean O'Brien responds to his misplay on a punt return as well as he did to his misplay on a punt return at Nebraska. Remember the fumbled punt on their own 2 yard line, setting up a Nebraska touchdown. This time, Bino with another mistake. Can he come back as well as he did in that game?
They'll measure. After the pass to Gaspard with 7:08 remaining in the third quarter. Second down and six was the play. And the first down marker just outside the 43. That's where they are, and they have a first down. Total yards now, 251 for Don James and the Huskies to 87 for Rich Brooks.
Well, Oregon offensively is really disintegrated. They've gone each and every week, less and less offense as the season has progressed.
First and 10 now from the 43.
Three receivers left. There goes Bryant to the right. He'll be the only receiver other than the tight end. Colbert is going to his tight end. Aaron Pierce down to the 40-yard line. Gain of three. There's Ed Cunningham, 79, the big center. One of the leaders on this team and a captain. James Batista on the tackle. Aaron's been quiet. No touchdown receptions this year. Had a good start against California, 2-3 receptions, but kind of quiet.
Kind of ended up with four receptions last week in the California game. By far his most productive day of the season. That's his first catch here today. He's too good a weapon.
Oh, yeah.
To not be a part of that Husky offense. But then Orlando McKay and Mario Bailey have been so successful on the outside.
Colbert had to get rid of it. That's because O'Berry, again, it's O'Berry. He seems to be the man who's not fooled by anyone today.
Well, he's a redshirt freshman, and he is going to be outstanding. In fact, in the preseason, he was pushing Darryl Smith for a starting spot there at the corner. And Herman O'Berry is a tough kid. He's not big, but he's strong. In fact, during one of the preseason drills, they were over at the practice field. He dove headfirst in one of those chain link fences to try for a ball and bounced right up. He's just a tough kid.
Huskies 5 of 12 on third down conversions today. It's third and six. Colbert wanting to get a lot of yardage again. Goes to Aaron Pierce again for the first down. Defended by Eric Castle, the safety, and good for 10 yards. Boy, they picked up an extra yard just on the velocity of the ball when he caught it.
Almost knocked him over.
Three consecutive throws to Aaron Pierce, two successfully. It's nice to have that arm strength there. You can see if that ball isn't thrown that hard, you've got the defenders are able to close that gap. Aaron Pierce catches that ball as much out of protection out of a desire for the first down.
He may have saved Eric Castle's life.
He saved Tony Pirro, the equipment man, the hassles of pulling that football out of that face mask, too.
First and 10. Dean O'Brien, and down, what a knee. Evidently, they didn't call it, but Terrell Edwards got him down. Yes, they did. Okay, the referee's back there. The line judge out along the line of scrimmage did not call it on the far side of the field who I was looking at. Uh-oh, Bino's hurt.
See, limping on that right knee with the bandage on it. That's the knee that gave him trouble early in the season. And see, once again, penetration by the Oregon defense. Terrell Edwards in there to make a play right there. Bino puts a lot of pressure on that right knee. You don't think about it when you're in the ball game, but as soon as the play's over, you realize something's not quite right. Again, Edwards, number 49, just rolled right there. You put so much stress on that right knee.
Second down and 16. Yeah, that had trouble written all over it. Mario Bailey, the intended receiver. Down goes the flag on Darryl Smith.
Well, Darryl Smith has to know. He has to know that when his team is going to blitz, he must make the receiver go to the outside. You cannot let an offensive wide receiver cut inside on a blitz because you have no help. You have to use the sideline boundary as another defender. And he let the receiver inside and had no option but to get in there before the ball came to the receiver.
Puts him in a tough position where you've got to play through the man to play the ball and either give up the reception or if you do go after the ball, it's tough timing on that. Smith has already been burned a couple times today by Mario Bailey. He's going to play that very aggressively.
So it'll be first and 10 for Washington on the 27 of Oregon. 4:57 remaining in the third quarter. McKay at the top of the screen and two receivers right. Here comes Barry. Going to go around the short side of the field. A couple of people there, though, along with Darryl Smith making the play. Batista also, number 45. Three of these defenders for Oregon have had interceptions for touchdowns.
Watch Aaron Pierce, the tight end, number 84, trying to get outside to get some leverage. Second down on Edwards, able to get just enough to let Jay Barry get around the corner when he goes forehead to forehead with Darryl Smith. Gain of six.
Smith is the man who had a 94-yard return on an interception. That was for a touchdown, wasn't it, Todd?
Yes, it was. New Mexico State.
Second and four. Barry trying to pound his way through.
Jay Barry, the ball carrier.
Looked like Gary Williams might have been involved in there.
James Bautista on the stop.
And Batista, number 45.
Malapai made a very nice play there. The hole looked to be bigger than it was. Jay Barry half a step late getting there. Malapai comes off the block of Ed Cunningham to stuff the play. Give his buddies time to get there.
Third down at seven. And got an injury to Malapai as he is trying to work his way off the field. Six, check that. 5'11", 254. Todd had talked about it earlier. He is one compact player.
Played at St. Louis High School in Hawaii, and for those familiar with what kind of football is played at that school, he played on a team that never lost a high school game. I mean, they just don't lose there. They won about seven or eight straight state championships in Hawaii.
Third down and two. Washington going with a double tight end formation. Leif Johnson, the man in motion. They go to Barry. Fighting his way. I don't know.
For about 2 yards.
You lose Malapai out of the middle of that Oregon defensive line, and Huskies try to take advantage of it. You're back to, in effect, your number three nose tackle, and they do not get the first down.
Well, they have listed a man named Jerry Kent.
Not to be confused with Clark Kent. But he's a tough kid, and he got good penetration there. And so for the second time today on fourth and short, the Huskies will go for it instead of trying a field goal.
Well, at least they're not doing what Bruce Snyder did last week against Washington, going fourth and short from deep in their own territory with very little to gain. Fourth and goal. Doesn't look like he made it.
Lost a yard.
Terrell Edwards with a great play in the Husky backfield. Give a lot of credit to that Oregon defense. Once again, they make some big plays when they have to.
Well, and let's not forget, Oregon plays great physical football.
Not the biggest team in the world, but they do have some speed and quickness. Not quite like the Huskies, obviously, but they do have speed and quickness, and they'll stunt and twist and do a lot of things to try to disrupt those blocking schemes.
Well, that's what you've got to do against an offensive line with the size of Washington. If you just line up and try to smash mouth with them, you're going to lose.
First and 10 then for the Ducks. Revive somewhat now. Two receivers to the left side, still looking for their first points of the day. Sean Burwell with one of his better runs of the day, good for about 8 yards. They gave him eight. Jane Palkoa in there, number 21, the man out of Murraysville Pilchuck High School. Burwell showing some of that acceleration.
Well, this is the longest running day by a running back for Oregon. Burwell, 8 yards, now has 23 yards on 15 carries. Tough afternoon.
Only a total of 38 for the whole Oregon team on the day.
He's not alone, though. Second down and two. Again, two receivers left. They go with Shedrick. Got the first down. He's up near the 30-yard line. Palkoa again involved on the play. Shane is going to be the guy. Here's what Todd had talked about earlier as far as yards.
Offensively, the first two games, they averaged 454.5 yards. And then in the last four games, it's just kind of gone downhill. They haven't been able to put things together. And they've only averaged about 270 yards per game.
And they're not getting the ball in the end zone either. Right. Only six touchdowns in the last 4 weeks.
First and 10. Wide receiver moved. Yep. Ronnie Harris on the top of your screen. And they were set too long before they could get away with any kind of man in motion. Malapai still being attended to.
On the offense.
But as far as that yardage, does that coincide with the injuries, like the defense, or what?
Well, obviously O'Neal was off to a pretty good start this year. He threw four touchdown passes against Texas Tech, tying a school record. And then against Utah, they just couldn't get things going. Utah's pressure defense, you hear that in basketball, but pressure defense, and the teams they've seen since then have used that pressure defense to slow them down.
First and 15 after the encroachment. Better hurry. Jeff Thomason wide open. He'd still be running if he'd have made the catch. Washington rolling the dice on that one, sending everybody but the equipment manager. And Croston had it. He had his man.
Well, you talk about execution. It's back to the old Tex Winter line. Asked him about his team's execution. He said, well, we'll consider that on Monday. But here's a situation where you've done everything right except throw and catch.
Yeah. We go back to our game keys at the beginning of the game. Oregon has got to take advantage of those big play opportunities on offense. There was one there that was not taken advantage of.
Second down and 15. The shift defensively.
Eight men up. Wanting to throw to Jones. And he was a forward pass. Not a fumble.
Washington, not a team that you want to try to get healthy offensively against. The number one defense against the run in the country, number three against the pass, number two overall, only giving up an average of 239 points, or 239 yards a game.
And they may move to number one because they were only two behind Clemson, 2 yards per game behind Clemson, and with their performance today, that's certainly going to help that overall average.
Obviously some time to go, but Washington number one before the Cal game, drops to two. At this pace, they'll certainly move back up.
Oregon needs 15 yards. It's third down. And three receivers to the left. Grosten. Comes to Marco Farr. Donald Jones throwing it up for grabs. Tommy Smith, interception. And he is tackled by Brian Brown. Flag down. And it's in the backfield. A little late hit on the quarterback, maybe, Todd.
I don't know if it was that or not, but that's a situation where he can't throw that ball where he threw it.
Contrast that to the way Musgrave played in the first half, the point that we were making. Never throw the ball late, back deep, over the middle. There's just too many people in there. The ball's in the air too long. You've got athletes like Tommy Smith. Something bad is going to happen if you're a quarterback.
Looked like a late hit maybe on Croston as he got rid of the ball, because that's where the flag was thrown.
And it'll negate that interception.
Well, it must have been late because it wasn't even in the picture. The replay was running.
Don James will be awake tonight thinking about some of these late hits and 15-yard penalties.
You're going to get a reminder during the week, I would think, from Don James. If you're a Husky player, one thing he will not tolerate is mistakes like that.
Well, one of the things that he has based his program on is discipline. And penalties like that are undisciplined plays, and he won't stand for that.
Yeah, they'll look at the film first, then he'll make his decision. First and 10. Look at that, 85 yards. Ball all the way up to the 41-yard line now as Burwell is met. Kabang, right on the line of scrimmage. Rogers, Jaime Fields. Some of the heavy hitters on his team met Burwell. DeMarco Farr. Second and 10.
Oregon now will go with four wide receivers. They will take out a tight end, Jeff Thomason, and the fullback, Juan Shedrick. Now try to spread the defense and try to find a gap in there somewhere.
Huskies have given up a total of two touchdowns in the second half all season. One of them was last week against California. Second and 10, back on the 41 of Oregon. Busted play, more than likely.
Well, we don't know if it was close to the
or Burwell.
Wrong, right? Or Burwell, so we won't make judgment.
I would tend to think it was Burwell. I mean, Croston, because the scheme looked like he was trying to go left.
2 weeks ago, in the huddle, Kyle called the play and never gave the snap count. And nobody in the huddle asked him what the snap count was. I mean, they're just lacking some leadership there. And those are the things that I think Musgrave was giving them in the first half.
Not
too bad with that broken finger he had to come out.
Well, the reason they call that an option play is because you're supposed to have an option, but when they're going the right way.
Third down and 11. The draw, nothing doing. Lunchtime. That's the sixth tackle for loss by Washington today. Reggie Rogers, one of the first there. Or excuse me, Tyron. How many times have I said that this year?
That's only twice.
Twice? That's pretty good.
That's only twice. Tyron Rogers, the starting nose tackle. Transfer from Oklahoma. Sat out a year. Backed up John Cook last year. This time in the Oregon Duck backfield again.
Tyron now with 4.5 tackles for losses this season. He may not have a lot of tackles, but when you're a nose guard, your job is to stand up a whole lot of centers and guards, and he's done it very well this year. That's it for the third quarter. Three in the books, one to go. We'll be back with that and much more right after this. A punt. Tommy Thompson, as we said, coming into this game, averaging almost 39 yards per. As we start the fourth quarter, Washington leading 22 to nothing. So far, a field goal of 33 yards by Washington has been in the second half. Pretty good boot. Napoleon Kaufman back to receive and returns it up to the 34-yard line. They want to get him in more and more as a kickoff and punt returner eventually. Right now it belongs to Bean O'Brien.
This program is authorized under television rights granted by the University of Washington. Any publication, reproduction, rebroadcast, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the expressed written consent of Prime Sports Northwest is prohibited.
As you see, no one has scored on Washington in the fourth quarter. And it's 22-0 right now. First and 10. Jay Berry still in the game. Hobart still in the game. Huskies as they lay it off to McKay at the 40. Should have the first down up near the 45-yard line. Gain of 11 yards by McKay.
The crossing route, good throw by Billy Joe Hobart. Orlando McKay full stride. 11.9 is what he averages per catch. Picks up 11 right here for another first down. Again, Husky receivers improved dramatically coming across the middle.
Andy Connor, the tackle, and Farwell in there to seal off the deal. Now first and 10. Three receivers going to McKay and Muhammad Oliver all over McKay. Good defense by Oliver.
And Terrell Edwards all over Billy Joe Hobart. Billy Joe throwing it on the back pedal.
But again, I go back to the schemes going in. Oregon knew they were shorthanded in terms of personnel, so you got to come up with ideas like this.
See Edwards coming in from the right of your screen. Let's put pressure on those guys. Let's not sit back and let them beat us.
Yeah.
Let's at least give it a try.
If anybody knows how to defend against a Keith Gilbertson offense, it's going to be Denny Shuler, who grew up with it.
They made the thing up together.
That's right. Second down and 10. Hobart wanting to go deep. Scott McKay. First down at the Oregon 42-yard line. Oliver and number 7, Coda, defending. McKay was fighting that hip pointer the week before the Cal game, 2 weeks before the Cal game.
Well, and when Oregon comes to town, he gets real excited. 2 years ago, he had 2 catches and a touchdown. Last year, he only had 1 catch for 45 yards and a touchdown. So he gets real pumped up to play against the Ducks.
So it's first and 10. Washington starting this drive at the very beginning of the quarter. Play action. Again, McKay gets around his man. Eric Castle can't bring him down. Coda took a shot at him, and Oliver was able to come back and make the play. Boy, some nifty running and moves by McKay after the reception of 17 yards.
Just go down the DB roster for Oregon. Those are the guys that had shots at Orlando McKay on this play. It's the Orlando McKay show here in the fourth quarter so far. You see, first Oliver gets a look at him, then Coda and Castle, Williams get a shot at him. And then Oliver gets a second chance and makes this one good.
First and 10, one more time. McKay this time to the left and Bailey to the right. Setting up the screen for Berry. He's down to the 20-yard line where Farwell meets him. Also, number 95, P.J. Cabrera, getting some action now. A redshirt freshman, had no stats coming into this game.
He hadn't played very often. He was third team behind, you know, Matt LeBounty. I mean, you're down to your third string defensive end.
I'm laughing at the look on your face, Todd, when I said, what, no stats? He hasn't played. They've got so many injuries, they're trying to bring everybody in. Jay Berry, little limp leg there, and is able to slide in on second down to near the 16-yard line. They can get the first down right at the 15.
Well, if anybody can coach defensive ends, it's probably Joe Sheffield, Oregon's defensive line coach. He's had a couple that have been pretty good. Think of guys like Dion Elshire, Mike Walder, Steve Bach, all of those guys played in the NFL. And they've always had pretty good defensive ends.
Third and one for Billy Joe, who's big enough to play defensive end. They go to Berry, and it'll be close again. And again, I go back to that muscle and the coaching of Oregon. They've always played the Huskies like this.
Well, it means so much to them. Obviously, Washington, the premier program, not only in the Northwest, but right now the West Coast. And you know, you like to play well against good teams, and sure. Washington has been good for so many years that Oregon gets up for them. They go against each other in recruiting quite a bit. They've got alumni that hear from each other in the offices each and every time the two teams play each other. It's a big game for both teams, but probably, in a lot of respects, bigger for Oregon than it is for Washington.
And it is a first down. 12:40 remaining for Rich Brooks and his team. And they have put on a respectable performance today, trailing only 22-0. Believe me, it could be worse. We've been here for the 54-0 with Arizona, the 56-3 with Kansas State. And Rich Brooks, if he had a full gun with all the bullets, he'd be giving Don James a heck of a game right now. Barry to the right side on first down.
Well, we had a shot of Brooks on the sidelines, and knowing Rich, he is disappointed, but not totally unhappy. That's kind of a bizarre way to say it, but I think that's the case. He wanted to see, after the California game, a team to come out and play with some heart, play with emotion, play hard physical football, and they have. Well, offensively, they haven't done anything, but defensively, the backbone of his program has played very well.
Second down and six. Ball on the 11 of Oregon. Billy's got to hurry. Here comes Bandison again. There's Connor. Gets rid of the ball. Interception. My goodness sakes. That is not what you do when you're rolling out of bounds and supposedly your veteran quarterback. Big mistake. As 54, Gary Williams, obviously his first interception, the left defensive end, a sophomore out of Fresno.
Well, you mentioned it, and I think maybe Billy Joe a little frustrated that they haven't had more success in trying to make something happen that just was not there. Connor with the pressure, and as Croston did moments ago when he threw one into the middle, and Chuck, you alluded it to, never.
Who is he throwing to?
Well, that's the question. Not only do you not throw it back over the middle, but you got to have somebody in mind to be throwing it to. There's nobody in there other than number 60s and 70s and 50s.
Kelly Malamala is about it.
Brainlock on the part of Billy Joe Hobart.
John Burwell, nothing doing on the left side. They'll give Sean 1 yard. Brett Collins, number 46, getting some good action here in the second half, making the tackle. 11:23 remaining in the game. It has been a less than sterling day offensively for the Huskies, and I'm sure the Huskies will be the first to say it. They were frustrated in that Cal game, Chuck. Remember afterwards, they were, hey, we got to go back and do a lot of work. You're not seeing a lot of improvement today.
A couple of turnovers on the part of Washington, 3 on the part of Oregon. Only 3, I'll say. Washington, the leader in the country in turnover margin.
Second down and 9. Here comes the pressure. Tommy Smith, they get the pass away anyway to the tight end, Jeff Thomason. He had 14 coming in. He's averaging about 15 yards per catch, so he's one of their deeper threats, tell you the truth. He's not running a long ways with it, but I mean.
Well, he has good size. He has great hands. Recruited by SC as a swimmer. So, whatever that means.
That's why he's got great hands.
He decided not to go to SC on a swimming scholarship because he said he went up there and watched one of their practices, and they practiced for about 7 hours. He said, that's too long.
Third down and 5. Ronnie Harris to the left side. Croston needs help. Lays it off. Ooh, found Brian Brown somehow between Brett Collins and Walter Bailey. 3 yard gain after all of that.
Well, that's a lot of work for 3 yards.
There's got to be a line about Thomas and something about his swimming and going up to be a duck, but I'm not going to, I don't know how to connect it, but there's a joke there somewhere.
Croston, good presence of mind. Again, throws it late back to the middle. This time gets away with it. Brown wishes he hadn't. Big pile on Mr. Brown this time.
It'll be fourth down. Napoleon Kaufman back to receive Thompson's punt with 9:33 remaining in the game. Huskies still shifting around defensively. The rush was on. Kaufman from the 30. Casually stepped away from the first defender. Did you notice that?
A little hop step to the side, buys himself a little bit of time.
The first man down there was the snapper, Willie Tate, a reserve tight end, but he just stepped around him like he wasn't there.
Supposed to come down under control as a tackler. Impossible with Kaufman. We'll be back.
Billy Joe Hobert still in at quarterback for the Huskies on first and 10 after the punt of 40 yards and a 7-yard return. Going deep, McKay, good for the first down right at midfield. Number four, Herman O'Berry again defending.
Four on four, and again, Orlando McKay, the primary receiver for Billy Joe Hobert here in the fourth quarter.
McKay's been a busy man today in terms of reception.
Catch and throw. Herman O'Berry makes his break on the ball. Cannot get around Orlando McKay. A good job of McKay keeping O'Berry on his back.
First and 10, right on the 50. Trips to the right side. And Matt Jones to the left, trying to swing across the middle. Now Billy Joe tucks it under his arm and is going to run. Gets about 5 yards to the Oregon 45-yard line, where Jalila Malapai makes the tackle.
Getting back to McKay, 8 receptions, 91 yards. Big afternoon.
Well, that tells you something, too, is that's a lot of receptions, 91 yards. Not a lot of long stuff, but he's getting those possession catches.
He's only averaging about 40 yards a game coming in. Mario Bailey, the big yardage guy, averaging 100 yards a game. Lionel McKay stepping forward today.
Second down and 5 after the scramble by Billy Joe. Huskies continue to go upstairs with the passing. And DeMario Bailey O'Berry brings him down.
That's Billy Joe Hobert.
But the one thing about O'Berry, at least he's been within a step or two of Bailey. I mean, he's a good cover guy. I mean, when Bailey was working on Smith and Muhammad Oliver, it was a carte blanche virtually. With Herman O'Berry, at least there's some, you know, defender in the vicinity in the same area, Coach.
He's made some nice physical plays here. You can see again, he's right there. Doesn't take long to get Mario Bailey to the ground. Remember, Herman O'Berry, also the guy that chased down Beano O'Brien on the punt.
First and 10 from the 35. Beano, he must be all right. Trying to get outside Eric Castle, nothing doing. Castle coming up well, number 12. The junior out of Lebanon, two-year Letterman. Gonna bang himself up a little bit, too.
He's been bothered with a bad back. In fact, he missed a game because of that back. And just the way he's walking, either a leg or maybe a lower back injury, a little hitch to get along there.
Ugh.
He's as good a safety as there is in the conference, and there are good safeties in this conference.
You can see him run here. Good pursuit angle. Doesn't give Beano a chance to cut back or outrun him to the outside.
Yeah, he's hurt.
See, he gets twisted up a little bit as they land. Got to go think about that.
Oregon's got to be thinking, let's get this season over with. Let's get healed and go on to 92.
Well, I think they'd like to just get, you know, get the game over with. And, you know, I know they have Stanford next week, but that's a game that I think the Oregon coaches believe if they can find some offense, they can win.
Yes. But in terms of injuries, yeah. I guess is the point I was making. Enough is enough. Second down and 9. Holbert with all afternoon. To throw to Gaspar, maybe coming back. Really not on the same page with Gaspar.
Well, he wanted to go to Bailey down the middle, but Oregon switched up its defense and kind of went from, let Bailey go from one safety to the next safety, so he was covered. And a good job by the secondary there, and Hobart really had to throw it away.
You know what I bet is concerning Don James? He's taking a shot at this, is that, remember, their coaching staff, like every coaching staff believes, you've got to improve every week. I don't think they're all that happy with the improvement they're seeing with the Huskies the last couple of weeks.
Exactly. Offensively.
Yeah.
Particularly offensively.
Yes.
Well, they've had opportunities to make plays, to get the ball in the end zone. They haven't taken advantage of them.
On third down, Baylor. He's had a busy day in the touchdown department already. Fights his way down to the 15-yard line where Chad Cutter makes the tackle. Hobert now 20 of 34.
His 11 TD catches this season breaks the Husky record set by Dave Williams in 1965, only 3 away from the Pac-10 season record. This makes 20 consecutive games that he has caught a pass. He is so dangerous after he catches the ball. Look at all these people that get shots on him. He almost gets away there from Coda.
First and 10 from the 15. Again, they throw the ball. McKay wide open. Touchdown. Beautiful job of keeping the feet inbounds. That's his third touchdown catch of the season on the 15-yard play. Orlando McKay, and the Huskies extended a little closer to that point spread. The line was predicted.
Once again, the Huskies have great success with what they call the post-corner route. You see nobody even in the picture as Orlando McKay catches the touchdown. Muhammad Oliver hanging around the inside, bit on the post part of the post-corner move.
Hanson's extra point is good. And there is 6:20 remaining in the ball game, and the Huskies extend the lead 29 to nothing on McKay's third TD catch of the season. Got a ways to go, though, to catch up with Mario Bailey, who's at 11. Be right back.
When it comes
Northwest this Tuesday at 4 for the Notre Dame football action, when the Fighting Irish fight with the USC Trojans right here. Prime Sports, Northwest. 29-0. Washington on top after the 15-yard touchdown pass to Orlando McKay. We should mention, after this play, this is brought up to the 38-yard line. And that was the tight end, Jeff Thomason, by the way. Billy Joe Hobert now with 13 touchdown passes, three today. And a scuffle of sorts on the field after that six-yard return by Thomason. I think Jeff was getting a little help moving the ball forward. Some folks decided to argue the pile came to rest.
I think if he had to do that again, he might fair catch it. You're allowed to fair catch a kickoff,
right,
which prevents somebody from hitting you before the ball gets there, as opposed to an onside kick, which I've always thought to really puts the team receiving in a precarious position, because
yes,
this guy's allowed to just splatter somebody without the ball even being there yet.
That's why the pooch kick is effective. First and 10. Jones to the right side, and a receiver to the left, and again, movement by Matt Martin, number 71, the left tackle for Oregon. Or was it Donald Jones? I'd be moving too if I had Donald Jones coming at me before the snap. And it's going against Oregon.
Husky touchdown, their first since early in the second quarter. See Joe Farwell here, not too happy about the way things are going today.
That was probably Brett Collins over there instead of Donald Jones putting the heat on Martin. The rollout. First. Interception. Washington. Looking for Ronnie Harris. Was it William Doctor, number 10? The wait. Oh,
Lewis Jones.
Lewis Jones came up with it. His first. In fact, his first in his career.
The redshirt freshman comes up with his first interception. Croston trying to make something happen that isn't there. You can see the kind of little delay route. If you ever saw Jones trying to get the ball to Ronnie Harris, Jones just hanging back there, makes the interception the first of his Husky career.
Mark Brunell into the ball game at quarterback. And a nice round of applause for him as he came in. So it's first and 10, and Brunell goes to Kaufman. Round of applause partly for him, too, as Kaufman comes in. He's become a crowd favorite, Todd.
Oh,
pure freshman.
He's electrifying.
Yes.
You know, he's got that great speed and quickness, might be the fastest of the tailbacks. I guess Dino doesn't want to actually race him in a 40-yard time to dash. But he's a tremendous athlete, and he's going to be a big, big part of this program for years to come.
Now, Vito Bryant and Kaufman in the backfield at the same time. I'm still waiting for that one.
See a lot of backups in there for Washington. Damon Mack in at wide receiver. It's offensive lineman, the first two teams virtually on the sidelines for the Huskies.
And we've got movements on an offensive lineman, number 62 for
Todd Bridge.
Washington.
A little
Todd
too anxious is his chance to get on the field. Had good technique, though.
Strong side tackle. 10 penalties for 90 yards on the Huskies today.
Well, what's it say about it?
David Reiner says, what are you doing? What are you doing?
Put your helmet on straight or what?
Shake them loose.
Second down and 13. Down to 5:25 remaining in the game. What a change a year makes. Mark Brunell was second leading rusher on this Husky team at this stage last year and had a great game against Oregon. What an injury can do to you. Kaufman, a lot of room. Well, we've seen that happen too. Gets so excited. And now flags go down. Kaufman lost his footing. We'll see what the flag's all about.
I think somebody lost their composure.
Gonna have a late hit on Frank Garcia. If we can get another look at it, we'll get a chance. We can look at the timing of it. Garcia trying to get downfield and make a block. Number 65. Is the block thrown after he's down? There he sees Napoleon down, and Garcia.
Not only is it a personal foul, it's a clip.
Would have been a clip.
Barely got his head in front of him.
These guys get pretty excited, those offensive linemen, when they get a chance to get downfield and throw some blows. But
yeah, so what?
You got to tuck that excitement in your back pocket.
Yeah, you got it. That's hard to excuse.
12 penalties?
That's 11, I believe.
11?
They're almost, well, they're over the century mark now. You're going to feel like the Oakland Raiders of old.
Yeah, 11-105. 105 yards. We got the Miami Hurricanes dressed in purple here today.
Third and 27. Hoffman, ooh, got through somehow all the way up the midfield. 10 yards short of a first down, but an electrifying play nonetheless of 17 yards. I don't know how he got through that seam.
I don't know how he did either. Just a little dump off to Napoleon Kaufman. Kind of guy you just want to get the ball in his hands and stand back and watch. How does he get through this?
Great speed. Yes, Ron Hardy missed an arm tackle, but that great acceleration. That's what coaches look for, acceleration, the ability to burst at the right time.
Well, he certainly gets into a pile and gets out the other side. He's not a guy that gets in there and dances around.
He got 17 of a need of 27, so they will have to punt again, that being Washington, and Brian Brown waits back on his own 10. We knew we're short a player. The Huskies are short at least one player, and they have to call a timeout. Looks like they were missing a left guard.
Get late in the game like this, and the guys get taken out at other positions, and they stop paying attention. Don James won't be happy with that either. Nothing drives a coach crazier than when you've got special teams play with not enough guys. You're running people on the field later. You're pulling people off because you've got too many. It just shows you that your players aren't thinking.
You're seeing mental mistakes today.
You got 11 penalties. You got guys not showing up. 12 penalties, excuse me. 12 for 110 yards. He won't like that.
Nice snap. And it's blocked by Cota. And he could go all the way if he can get around the punter. And he's finally brought down.
Nice play by Jay Berry and John Wardell. But Muhammad Oliver makes the block of the punt. You get a look at just how important the snap is. Not only does it have to be low, but it's got to be on target. The snap from Bruce Bailey took John Wardell right over into the rush of Muhammad Oliver. Ted Cota getting his pulse taken, making sure he's okay.
And keep in mind how long it's been since anybody's started from the line of scrimmage inside the Washington 20. Oregon's only 6 yards away. First and 10. Burwell. He could score if he keeps his feet. He does it. Touchdown, Oregon.
First touchdown all year that the Huskies have given up in the fourth quarter. Direct result of special teams play by the Oregon Ducks. Burwell with a great run to get it into the end zone for the Ducks' first points of the day.
And again, several reserves for Washington, but still, that is the first touchdown of the year given up in the final 15 minutes. 25-yard run by Burwell.
Well, you can see not only the elusivity he has, but the burst that he has, too. He just hasn't had many holes today. And he finally got one, and boom, he's gone.
Did a nice job of keeping his feet, too.
Very well blocked. Again, the burst between DeMarco Farr and Danaka Smith. Then you see the heart of Sean Burwell, not going to get stopped before he gets into the yellow paint.
Drake McCallum finally gets on the field, and his extra point is good. And so that quickly, a blocked punt. And a 25-yard run by Sean Burwell with some good blocking by the folks up front. And the Oregon Ducks are on the board. Proud to present the Rainier and Rainier Light play of the game. And it came up in the first half. And Mario Bailey with his 11th touchdown reception this season, setting a school record.
Not only does this put the Huskies up 13-0, but Mario Bailey breaks the school record for most touchdowns in a season with 11.
Touchdown receptions.
Receptions, yes. Play of the game was brought to you by Rainier and Rainier Light. Around here, it's Rainier. 25-yard touchdown run by Sean Burwell. 4:21 remaining. Oregon will kick off. Tommy Smith with the barefoot. Tommy Thompson, rather, will be kicking off. Barefooted, huh, Todd?
That's full darn cold, but he's always done that. Of course, he punts.
But now he punts
with
he
the shoe on.
Wears a shoe.
That's right. When he kicks off, he feels he does a better job with the shoe off.
Guys like him that start those kicker jokes going around.
Tommy Smith from the 15. Ooh, going outside. Stiff arms one man and is finally knocked out of bounds at the 29 by Muhammad Oliver. Bailey now, 7 receptions for 107 yards and 2 TDs. Smith's return was good for 14 yards.
No Husky touchdowns on the ground today. All through the air. 3 touchdown passes by Billy Joe Hogan.
Spent a lot of time going upstairs today.
Well, they couldn't run the ball consistently. Yeah. They probably averaged under 3 yards or around 3 yards a carry.
137 yards rushing, 274 passing. Joe Farwell, when it comes to heart, I think he has the biggest on that Oregon team. Darius Turner on first down.
Farwell may only weigh 200, but most of that weight might be in the heart.
Yeah.
He's, you know, he just played his heart out today, played so well, and yet comes up on the short end of the scoreboard.
Always been a fan of his. Anyone that can play at that size, inside linebacker. Really incredible ability.
Co-captain as a junior. Not a senior, but as a junior.
Yeah.
Shows the respect that he has from his teammates. Well, we're not the only ones who think that he sets a great example.
Second down and 7. Don't worry, Joe. You get the Huskies in Eugene next year. Grinnell still a quarterback. Kaufman the tailback. Well, if you tried to put it in a nutshell, this would be about it. Oregon with 129 total yards. They do have one thing to brag about, and that's that touchdown in the fourth quarter. Huskies Hobart with 3 touchdown passes today. 2 to Bailey, 1 to McKay. And the penalties will be one of the first things that Don James talks about.
Well, maybe the best thing out of this besides a victory for Washington is they got Travis Hansen in track.
Yes, very much so.
3 field goals today for Travis.
3rd down and 4. Kaufman finds the handle. Gets away from a couple of people. He's always about 2 people away from springing one. Chad Cota, one of the people in on the tackle.
He sure makes you hold your breath when you get the ball to him.
He got the first down up to the 40-yard line. Now, he's electrifying, as Todd said.
For a guy with his speed and elusiveness, he's also so aggressive. Saw there, he delivered the blow to Chad Cota. He gets into traffic, and once he knows he can't elude the guy, then he's the guy that initiates contact. But he's going to knock the guy right off of him.
Good running backs always fall forward.
Yes. 1st and 10. And we've got 2:27 left in the game. Kaufman again, pops it this time, all the way down to the 42-yard line.
Not to take anything away from him, but he's also coming into a situation in most of the games where a lot of folks are a little tired, too. He's fresh, and he's got that burst. Boom, he's gone right through David Massey. 17-yard gain.
Ed Cavs makes the tackle after, 17-yard gain. And you're right, fresh legs make such a difference.
It'd be kind of fun to see him get the ball 15 or 20 times a game, though.
Yeah.
See what could happen. You might have a couple of big plays both ways, but you're gonna have fun looking at it.
It'll be fun either direction. 1st and 10. Here we go again. Uh-oh. Trying to go outside, then cuts back in. Well, he made a lot of something out of virtually nothing. Got 5 yards on a play that was jammed at the line of scrimmage.
It made a good decision for the freshman there, too. At a point there, you thought he was going to try to go all the way back across the field and outrun some people. But he made the decision not to do it. Gets into traffic here. Tries to get outside. No, I guess not.
That was a good move.
Yes.
There comes a point when you're a running back where you have to say, hey, I'm not going to break this for a touchdown. I'm going to tuck my head down. I'm going to get what I can get.
Call it Greg Lewis.
Line up again.
Lewis was so good at that. He could go for the big one, or he could muscle with the best of them. 2nd and 5. Darius Turner busted loose down to the 20-yard line. Eugene Jackson, the left cornerback, one of the first to get to it.
Turner getting some good work. 18 yards, his longest run of the year by far.
Only 4 yards coming into the game was his longest run of the year. You can see the Washington running backs getting through the line of scrimmage fairly cleanly here. Kaufman the last couple of plays. This time, Darius Turner again.
And he knows how to put two arms around the football. First and 10 on the 20-yard line. Huskies trying to put more up on the board with 49 seconds remaining. Toss sweep. Kaufman. He still got more than I expected him to get. Down to the 16. Todd's got to take off. He's got to go down and do the interview with the coach later on. So, Todd, thanks for being with us. See you, buddy.
Nice working with you.
Do the Rich Brooks interview. 25 seconds to go in the game. So we will talk with Todd during basketball season. 16 seconds left. Joe Kralik wide to the left side. They're going to give it to Kaufman. Nothing doing. And that's going to do it for the ball game. So Kaufman and Darius Turner with a couple of nifty runs and some good blocking in front of him. That's going to end the game. Don James goes 12-3 against Rich Brooks in their series between the two of them. As the Huskies come up with a victory 29-7. Next year we head south to play in Eugene. Two of the longest in terms of tenure coaches in the Pac-10. 15th year for Rich Brooks and 17th for Don James. Huskies 7-0 overall, 4-0 in conference play. Oregon goes to 3-4, 1-3 in Pac-10 play. Back in a moment.